92.7 WNEW, New York.
You are one pathetic loser.
Broadcasting live from beautiful Midtown Manhattan. On a clear night, you can almost see Manhattan parents actually complaining about having law and order in their schools. It's the Ron and Fez Show, and I'm your announcer, Thing 3. And now, let's introduce your host. Two guys who think Tanya Harding deserves a gold medal for her drunk driving plea bargain. Here they are, Ron Bennington, Fez Watley, radio's judge and jury.
The Ron and Fez Show. It's a live show, August 6th. Beautiful weather in New York today, Fez. Couldn't ask for anything better.
Oh, it's such a relief. I only sweated through one shirt today, not all three. It's so nice. It feels good.
It is the Ron and Fez Show, 877-692-1027. I believe tomorrow night, if you go to ronfez.net, you can start and vote for a ton of bands that are vying for the chance to be in the Ron and Festival of Rock and Ribs.
Ron and Festival of Rock and Ribs, it's going to be Friday night, August 23rd at the beautiful Hard Rock Cafe, West 57th Street in Manhattan. By tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, all the bands should be up on ronfez.net. I think over 350.
I don't know the final tally there.
We're not going to have the final tally till tomorrow, but it's going to be close to 400.
Yikes!
Too many.
Too many to vote for. So, yeah, you can...
We're only taking five bands?
Only five bands, that's correct. The best five.
All right, now this sounds impossible.
Yeah. It's ridiculous.
So we think about 7 o'clock tomorrow, we'll make the official announcement that you can start voting then on ronfez.net to see who will perform live at the Ron and Festival of Rock and Ribs. Of course, the Mighty Mighty Mosh Tones will be on the bill.
Yes, they will.
Featuring Mosh and doing Papa Don't Preach.
Which now seems so old with Anna Nicole blowing up overnight. We should have her sing the Anna Nicole theme song.
Anna Nicole getting some nice ratings in for her hideous E! Show.
And it's such a terrible show. It's not fun.
It's really, really bad. I don't know why. You'd think she's so dumb and so out of it that it would be nonstop hilarity, that we could all just sit and point and laugh. But there's nothing to laugh at. She's just rolling around in a bed.
I think too many people that have dated Down Dot Freaks before don't want to watch it now.
It hits too close to home for some people. 877-692-1027. So her first week out beat the Osbournes' debut. So people want the reality, but this show isn't going to last.
This is going to be like the XFL, where it started at the top, Fezzy, and then went down every week.
Every week the XFL was getting that audience cut in half or more.
Unless they have something funnier planned for the show. But as of right now, nah.
But, you know, a big, fat, downed-out girl going house hunting.
Yeah, you got to do more with her.
Yeah, they're not poking her with a stick.
And even then, if you poke her with a stick, it's not a reality show. If suddenly, you know, we make her go to a water theme park while she's fat and downed out. That's just...
But it reminded me of, like, when you go to the zoo and you want to see, like, the gorilla exhibit, and you get there... And they're not doing nothing. They're just laying around in the sticks.
Right.
That was her, just laying there, wherever she went house hunting and laid down in every house she visited.
Oh, Roy wants me to announce this, too. If you're a big-ass card holder, check your emails.
Oh,
because
okay.
the first invitations, the first tickets to the Ronin Festival of Rock and Ribs are going out through email right now just to the big-ass card holders.
So make sure if you are a big-ass card holder, you do check your email because the Ronin Festival of Rock and Ribs, that's a private party. It's invite only.
And if you you know, are a frequent listener to the show, you want to have a big-ass card. Because membership, my friends, has its privileges.
It certainly does. One of those privileges is you have a chance to get into this private party, the Rockin' Ribs Festival.
And who knows, Fezzy? Who knows what could happen that night? One of these bands could launch, so you're basically looking at the next Deep Purple.
I'm predicting it's the Mosh Tones.
And really, what happened with Deep Purple? The, you know, the whole smoke on the water thing? Is that over? Is that done?
Apparently it's all through.
How could it be? You had everything there. What, does everybody just turn their attention to Blackmore's Rainbow? I don't understand it. Hot Liz wants to talk to us about the Anna Nicole Show, Fezzy.
All right.
Hot Liz, how you doing, honey?
Did you watch this train wreck of a show?
Yeah, it was awful.
It was terrible. It was like a car accident. I hated every second of it. I was disgusted, but I had to sit there just all bug-eyed watching it.
Yeah, I watched it, too, and I was hoping it would kick in and be fun.
You know, I watched, Liz, I watched the two-hour Hollywood Story beforehand.
I watched that, too, Fezzy.
And was bored out of my skull. She wasn't interesting then in the middle of a court battle.
And she got terribly fat.
Do you think? She put on a little weight, I guess.
Just a little. And you reminded me something about someone else talking about Deep Purple.
Yeah.
Did you ever notice that Smoke on the Water and Cat Scratch Fever are the exact same song?
All right, we'll look into that.
Look into it. It's exactly the same song.
All right, here's Smoke on the Water, which we're really trying to have another Deep Purple come out.
Now sing Cat Scratch Fever while you're listening to it.
All right, hold on. We got Cat Scratch Fever. We're putting that in the other deck here.
The Nuge.
All right. Are we ready here?
We ready with Cat Scratch?
I guess it could be a speeded up Smoke on the Water. All right, thanks for the tip, Hot Liz.
Yep, all right, you're the best. I love you guys. Bye-bye. Right.
Thank you, Hot Liz.
Wonder Boy writes from the other room that Hush was his favorite Deep Purple song. Come on, my friend, Highway Star, we're forgetting about that.
It's nice that Wonder Boy's keeping up a correspondence.
Well, Wonder Boy is running the dump button tonight.
Oh, thank goodness. Nice.
I don't know how we're going to get by without Rudy, who's going to play foosball and go in and bug Joe Dirt all night.
And now I saw him asleep on a couch the other day, so maybe he's just still asleep. Looked high as hell.
Oh.
Rudy.
He's always high.
877-692-1027 is the toll-free phone number. Ronnie, I'm excited about some film projects that are coming out.
Good.
Finally, they're doing something. Some of the stuff that people really want to see in the movies. Finally, the good stuff. I'm looking at this thing, Batman versus Superman.
Ah, this is the Jude Law project.
Right, they're tapping Jude Law as the next Man of Steel.
I don't know about that.
So, and I think they're talking either Colin Farrell or someone else as Batman.
Why not Colin Quinn as Batman? folks, I'm here. I'm ready to rescue you, folks.
Stop, Joker. It's his Batcave. It's his Batmobile. It's his rules.
But seriously, everybody, I don't... Hello?
So also with Batman versus Superman, they're also announced that they're put it together Freddy versus Jason.
Mm.
Freddy Krueger versus Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th. They got the actual Freddy Krueger, Robert Englund, on board, like he had anything to do. And they're using Brad Renfro as the attractive lead. He'll be running from both of them.
This is kind of like in wrestling where your heat is off, so they tag team you.
Oh, there you go.
Or somebody else.
Right. And then also another project, Alien versus Predator.
Why are they all versus each other?
This is excellent. It's some of the movie fights we've always wanted to see.
Now, we're going to sit and watch Alien fight with Predator?
Predator is probably going to go out hunt Alien. Alien, more of a creature. Predator, you know, kind of an intergalactic safari guy.
Yeah, I know. What is going to help him, you know, when he's changing shapes and everything, if he's inside that spaceship where Alien lives?
Who are you picking in that one?
Oh, let me think. Alien versus Predator? Give me Alien.
Yeah? I'm going with the Predator. He's got the gadgets. He's the hunter.
Is Sigourney Weaver in this?
I don't know if
you ever see
Ripley's going to be in it.
You ever see Alien run away from anybody?
So that.
Don't worry about Alien, Fezzy. Pound for pound, one badass.
Oh, it's going to be a hell of a fight, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But I had the feeling Predator's going to take this one. I think that was actually a comic book, Alien versus Predator. I think they did a comic book series on that one.
We'll wait for Big Kev to call.
877-692-1027. So finally, send the movie matchups that you've always wanted to see. Me, I'm hoping they do something like Forrest Gump versus Rain Man.
Forrest Gump versus Rain Man?
Yeah.
Give me Gump.
Gump? Rain Man, much smarter. Gump, more physical. Gump would kill Rain Man, unless he can figure out a way out of it.
Yeah, I mean, really, what can Rain Man do besides talk? The only way Rain Man will come out of this okay is if Tom Cruise helps him.
Or if
again.
If it's a toothpick kind of contest.
And it won't be. Not in a movie. What about Jaws versus Free Willy?
Oh, nice, because Free Willy, killer whale. Against Jaws.
But Jaws, almost a kind of a super shark. And did Free Willy ever go out and kill anybody? He seemed awful nice and captive.
Free Willy seemed to have the, just the spirit beaten out of him. You know what I mean?
Right.
When they finally freed him, he was sick in that tank and everything.
Because his thing was falling over.
Oh, yeah, his dorsal fin had flopped.
So, yeah, a healthy Free Willy, sure. But a depressed Free Willy? Or unfree Willy? You give me Jaws.
Willy, your fin is limp.
All right, Aaron writes in, what about RoboCop versus Terminator? Not even close, my friend. Give me T2.
Yeah.
He'd kill RoboCop.
Terminator would actually go after RoboCop and have him for lunch. There's no doubt about that one.
All right, here's one for you from Dickie. Happy Gilmore versus Joe Dirt. That would be actually a good movie. Give me Happy Gilmore.
All right, what about, like, Chucky? You know who Chucky is?
Sure, the little doll, the mean doll.
Right, against that ventriloquist dummy from the movie Magic. Well, we just have a couple of really evil little dolls going at each other.
I got to go with Chucky on this one.
The only way the magic dummy could win is if he, you know, talks, convinced his ventriloquist into killing Chucky.
Here's John. John, you're around the Fez.
Hey,
John.
Guys. Hey, buddy.
You screwed up. It shouldn't have been Free Willy against Jaws. You could do Free Willy against Flipper, but you got to do Jaws against Orca.
Orca the killer whale who bit off Bo Derek's leg.
Now, there you go.
Which was a terrible movie, and then when he bites off Bo Derek's leg, Fez, the screams. The leg just falls to the bottom of the ocean.
Oh.
Wow, I would actually pick Orca in that, except if you get him up in the Arctic.
Yeah, but Orca...
Remember they let him into the Arctic?
Oh, yeah.
It was the stupidest gimmick. They just kept driving. Instead of getting off the boat onto land, they tried to take him into the ice.
And Orca went up that house, remember?
Yeah, Orca went into a house after him.
What the hell's that?
Who was the guy in that movie?
Who was an Orca?
It was like a Michael Caine lookalike,
yeah,
right?
But it's not.
It's not Michael Caine.
Oh, God.
All right, we'll look it up, John.
He had a slight accent, too, didn't he?
Yeah, they all do.
It's true.
That's it.
We'll figure it out. The instant feedback and the phones always beat the producers.
Sure, always, 100% of the time.
Let's see if anyone gets it on the instant feedback at WNEW.com. You can go to the Ron and Fez page there.
Richard Harris.
Did they get it?
Thank you very much.
They always win.
I know he had an accent. I know he seemed like Michael Caine, which Richard Harris does.
All right, how about this? A Battle of the Misfits.
Mm-hmm.
Edward Scissorhands versus Powder. Now, Edward Scissorhands does have the... Scissor hands. But powder has magnetic powers.
The problem was that Powder was molested by his director. I have to go with Edward Scissorhands.
I think I'll take Powder in that one.
I can't imagine Powder winning a fight. He was always crying.
And getting his pants pulled down.
Yeah.
And shoved in the mud. Edward Scissorhands wasn't much better.
Although I think if you had to be with a guy like in prison, might as well be Powder.
Well, you want, if you had to be with a guy in prison, you want the guy who resembles the chick the most. The most chick-like guy.
Well, that goes back to Edward Scissorhands now. Now you flip back on me. Tim, you're on Iron Fez.
Hey, Tim.
799.
All right, buddy.
Hoo-ah!
I got Buckwheat versus Farina. Who would win there?
Buckwheat? Oh, yeah, give me Buckwheat any day.
I love Buckwheat.
Now, what about Stymie, though? It could be a three-way.
Stymie is my all-time favorite. If it's a three-way dance, I'm going to take Stymie. And I'll tell you why. The speed, the pure speed of that Stymie. And it's forgotten about for some reason.
I'll go with Buckwheat still.
Over Stymie?
Yeah.
With Farina in there mixing things up?
I remember the episode where they put Buckwheat in there just to spar with Alfalfa. And he had the big boxing gloves on. And he just kept rubbing his nose with them. And then he punched Alfalfa right in the eye. And Alfalfa saw stars.
Here's Troy on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Troy.
What's up, guys? Hey, buddy. Yeah, card holder 4540.
Hoo-ah!
Yeah, all of these things have been derived from comic books. I mean, everything you talked about has been out in comic book form.
Wait a minute. Stymie, Farina, and Buckwheat in a three-way dance was in a comic book?
Because I want that one.
What book, my friend? That's a collector's
item. Not that one, but I'm talking about Alien versus Predator and all of that. But there's one they haven't talked about yet.
Who won Alien versus Predator?
Who won it in the comic book?
Who knows? It's been like 14 editions. Each one wins one, you know. Then they
I hate that about comics.
This is going to be a long movie.
Yeah, hello?
Yes.
Oh, okay. The one you forgot about was Alien Nations and Planet of the Apes.
Oh, it's not even close.
You know how the ship landed in, modern-day America? Well, they're going to say it landed now in the Planet of the Apes time.
Nobody's going to beat those apes.
Damn you! Damn you all to hell!
I like apes. Apes good.
Here's Tommy. Tommy Aaron and Fez.
Tommy.
Shake it up.
Shake it up, buddy.
Shake it up. Shake it up.
How can I beat? How about the Warriors versus the Wanderers?
Warriors versus Wanderers.
Classic.
I'll tell you what.
Classic.
My problem with the Wanderers, they always...
No wrongs, no orphans. The Wanderers and the Warriors.
What about the Baldies? Because the Wanderers actually ran away from the Baldies. And then those crazy Turnbull AC's. People. Yeah.
That was the other bull group chasing the Wanderers. I think it was the Turnbull AC's or something like that.
But the Warriors.
Warriors, come out to play.
The Warriors had that great 70s look.
Yeah.
Where you would wear a shoelace as a headband.
Yeah.
It's not going to help you at all, but you just look cute.
That's not going to catch a lot of sweat.
Wasn't supposed to, Fez. It was supposed to look kind of dancerish.
Oh.
Like everybody was doing an off-Broadway dance thing.
Thanks for the call, Tommy. 877-692-1027.
Joe, you're on Ron and Fez.
Joe.
Hey, Ron and Fez.
Yeah.
Hey, how about Harry Potter versus Frodo from Lord of the Rings?
Harry Potter versus a Hobbit.
Is it in Quidditch? Because in Quidditch, you got to go with Potter. I'll tell you something about that Potter. He never seems to lose. That's the problem with him. Every book, that little son of a bitch comes out on top.
I'm convinced. I'll take Potter.
Okay.
Give me Draco Malfoy.
Thanks for the call, Joe.
Here's Brian. Brian, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Brian.
Hey, what's going on?
Hey,
guys?
Buddy.
Shake it up.
Oh, shake it up.
Shake it up.
Shake it up.
How can I beat me? Shake it up.
All right, you ready? Mrs. Doubtfire versus Tootsie.
Wow, and the unfunniest hit of all time.
Unfunny drag hits.
Later.
All right, that's it.
Give me Mrs. Doubtfire.
Give me Tootsie for no apparent reason.
All right.
Give me Tootsie, and I wish we never even had the conversation.
What about Mr. Nanny versus Mrs. Doubtfire? Couple of guys taking care of kids. You got to go with Mr. Nanny, right, Hulk Hogan?
Again. This is the third worst movie of all time. Andy, you're on Iron Fez.
Andy, what you got, buddy?
buddies.
Hey, buddy.
Okay, this is going to sound like a mismatch, but Rosemary's Baby versus Three Men and a Baby.
I'll tell you, that Rosemary's Baby, I still run past the Dakota because of that movie. That scared the F out of me. That's the worst thing that could happen, that everybody's in on the gimmick but you. Your neighbors, your spouse, your doctor, whoever it is, they all know the secret, you don't.
I'll take Rosemary just because Three Men and a Baby have the liability of Steve Guttenberg.
The only problem with Rosemary's Baby is that when it grew up, Woody Allen banged it. That's the thing that nobody was ready for. That was the secret horror end of Rosemary's Baby.
We knew no good was going to come out of that. We didn't know how horrible. 877-692-1027. Talking about the new Versus movies that are coming out. We got Batman versus Superman, Alien versus Predator, and Freddy versus Jason.
Hey, Frank, you're on the fence.
Frank.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, I got a good one for you guys. Mini-Me versus Yoda. Just think of the implications.
First of all, this is not going to be close. Yoda is skilled in the ways of the Force.
But just think of it. If Mini-Me gets his hands on Yoda and starts humping him, it's all over.
No, it ain't going to happen. You know, if you want to be silly and start talking about things like that, but we saw Yoda work.
We know how Yoda fights. He's going to kill Mini-Me. I don't even care if it's a handicap match against Mini-Me and Simon Birch.
I'm telling you right now, Samuel L. Jackson doesn't want to fight Yoda. Jeff's heart sang when he saw Yoda fighting.
It was that beautiful. 877-692-1027.
Josh, you're on Ron and Fez.
Josh.
Yeah, what's up, buddies?
Hey, buddy.
Yeah, I got two. I got Austin Powers versus James Bond.
Look, if you don't want to take this seriously, just tell us so, okay? I mean, if you're not going to sit here and have a serious conversation, because one is real and the other is a comedian.
All right. But anyway, who would you think would win that one?
It's not even close. James Bond, of course.
James Bond beats Austin Powers. It's so obvious. They wouldn't even put that one down in a script.
Ben, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Go ahead, Ben.
Yeah, I had, what about Critters versus Gremlins?
Critters versus Gremlins. Man, those Critters were damn mean.
Hell yeah, absolutely.
I'm going to go with Critters.
But were they thrown in water? Because thrown in water, you got to go with Gremlins. It really depends on where...
Gremlins were the ones that would die in the water.
What's that?
Oh, no, with Critters, too.
Gremlins actually got stronger in water.
Yeah, gremlins multiply with water. It was bright light that killed the gremlins.
Right.
That's right, that's right.
So it really depends on where they're fighting at.
I need a venue.
I mean, they're going to fight in a bay, you go with gremlins. You're going to fight known, you got to go with critters.
All right, Ronnie, what about this one? Mm-hmm. Let me throw this out to you. Die Hard versus Lethal Weapon.
For me personally... Die Hard.
Die Hard.
And I'll tell you why. He won't stop coming. And yippee-ki-yay, mother effer.
Here's what I'd like to see in that matchup. It's like John McClane has to save his wife before Mel Gibson and Danny Glover have to save Danny Glover's daughter. Or something bad happens. You know what I mean? One's going to get killed. Whoever saves theirs first wins.
Come out to the coast. Get together. Have a few laughs.
Here's my thing about Die Hard. Does he need a friend? No.
No.
Then later, like Die Hard 3, he needed a black friend to run around with. That kind of bugged me. All right, here's Moose. Moose, you're on Ron and Fez.
Moose, what can we do for you?
Hey, friend. What's up? I got a good one. How about Scarface versus The Godfather?
I'll tell you right now. Anytime I watch an MTV Cribs, all the young rappers bring up a Scarface. Young brothers love Scarface like no other movie. That's their Goodfellas that they know every line from.
I got, and dude, one more thing. That old dude from Orca, he's the same guy who was in Gladiator, the Caesar who was dying.
You know, you're talking about Richard Harris, a great, great actor. He's not just the old guy.
The old guy for Gladiator.
You know, we remember...
The man had a whole history of work.
Sure, we remember him as A Man Called Horse and The Return of A Man Called Horse. We saw him get hung up by his nips before. You're not going to sit here and teach us about Richard Harris. Mutiny of the Bounty. Screaming actor. Screams every line.
Yeah, good point. Always angry, in agony, or something.
Yeah. Just veins are just bulging in every movie.
He's projecting.
Roy, why do the Young Brothers love Scarface so much? Tony Montana.
I think because he was just so crazy.
I think it's because he went from poor to rich so fast.
Yeah, I
agree
with that.
I think that's the deal with him.
I think also that he didn't take crap from anybody either.
Who did I see from Miami the other day that was on MTV Cribs?
Ludacris?
No, Ludacris is Fatlanta. He's down in the dirty south. This was a young Miami rapper. Guy looked like he had a house maybe worth $240,000. Took everybody all through it.
Beautiful.
$240,000 tops in Miami. That's Florida prices. I can't think of the guy's name. It's like a King something maybe. Ah. I didn't even know it was hit. I was cracking up.
On WWE Confidential, they did like a Crips thing with Booker T, who had to show us his microwave. His
same
great
deal.
Microwave oven. The exact same thing that always happens on Cribs.
Here's PR. PR, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
PR, what's going on?
Hey, buddy.
This is actually a quiz. Spider-Man versus Wolverine, and I had the answer.
All right, hold on. Why? Because it was already in a comic book?
Yep.
I'll say Spider-Man.
Not that I care so much about that whole universe over there.
The Marvel universe.
You know, give me Wolverine because he's got all those friends that can help him.
You got it. Wolverine won. He shredded his behind.
He shredded his web, right?
Yep.
Did he kill him?
No, he just like...
Is Spider-Man
so
dead?
Bad.
All right, that's it.
Thank you for the info.
Here's Sean. Sean, you're on Ron and Fez.
Sean, what do you got, buddy?
About the Outsiders versus the Jets from West Side Story.
Do for John! Do for John!
Stay gold, Pony Boy. Stay gold.
The thing about the Jets is they were New Yorkers. And Pony Boy and the Outsiders lived like in Oklahoma.
Right.
They get their asses whipped. Plus, every time they fight, half their gang dies. But I honestly do think the Outsiders were more sensitive.
Well, yeah, you know, they would stop the rumble, actually, to go save some kids in a burning church.
And then, ironically, that guy who got killed in the burning church went on to become Karate Kid.
Isn't that weird?
That's true.
So that's the thing that I try to tell myself at the end of the movie, when I'm all choked up. He's going to be Karate Kid, I keep saying to myself over and over.
What about Karate Kid versus Sidekicks? That kid who did the movie with Chuck Norris.
Sidekick.
Both a couple of guys that got picked on and then learned karate.
Sidekick is younger. Karate Kid's got to be like 60 now.
He's the Karate Man. Karate Grandpa.
What about the second Karate Kid?
The girl?
Yeah.
Hilary Swank?
Yeah, the Boys Don't Cry girl.
Yeah. People might think she's a guy. She could probably win.
Ah, here's the Karate Kid song. Was this from Karate Kid 2?
Yeah. Peter Cetera.
All right, that's on the instant feedback, Fez.
Right?
Spy Kids versus Goonies.
The Goonies. I know the Spy Kids got the gadgets, but the Goonies will find a way.
You know what I would say to the Spy Kids?
What's that?
Well, to fire the Goonies up about Spy Kids? It's their time up there, but it's our time down here. I thought we were going to see the return of the Goonies where they're all in the 30s.
Yeah, they said Richard Donner came back and he got all the Goonies together. Every Goonie was somehow available.
Richard Donner directed that movie?
I think that's Richard Donner, right?
Wow, and then he went on to do all those action pictures. Started with Goonies.
Double check on the Richard Donner for me. But I think he rounded up all the Goonies. Oddly enough, every single one of them available to do a film.
All right, Fezzy, Big Kev sent in a couple for you. See if how you deal with those.
Okay.
Scorpion King versus Conan.
Oh, let's go with Scorpion King.
Conan would destroy him. Huge sword on Conan. Huge. The guy had a sword that looked like a ladder. Poltergeist versus The Exorcist. My friend, this doesn't even go one round. Exorcist destroys.
Exorcist.
Samuel L. Jackson, Shaft versus Richard Roundtree, Shaft. Richard Roundtree. Richard Roundtree wins that.
There you go.
Darth Vader versus the Dark Lord from Lord of the Rings.
Vader. Give me Vader.
I got to go with Vader, too. Although, I wouldn't pick young Vader.
No, not this Anakin. Anakin. Not yet, anyway. He's got a ways to go. He's got some things to learn. What about Shaft versus Superfly?
I'm going to tell you right now, that Shaft is one bad mother...
Shut your mouth!
Just talking about Shaft.
I can dig it.
I think Shaft would win.
Who are we talking about? Richard Roundtree versus Ron O'Neill?
Ron Pofield.
Oh. Well, they're definitely Shaft. 877-692-1027.
Chris, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Chris.
Hey, guys.
Hey, buddy.
Buddy.
What do you got? Gladiator against Patriot.
Gladiator.
I'll take Maximus.
You gotta go Gladiator.
Yeah.
I know the Patriot can swing that hatchet around, but I'll still go with Maximus.
Gladiator. Yeah. Not even close. That Patriot didn't even do it for me. I'm going to tell you the truth. I know that seems unpatriotic.
Now he's finding crop circles. This guy can't catch a break.
Here's Dan. You're on Ron and Fez.
Dan, what can we do for you?
Buddy.
Hey, buddy.
Buddy.
Big ass 13635 here.
All right, my friend.
Hoo-ah! All right, I got a triple threat match between Benji, Lassie, and Jerry Lee, the dog from K-9.
The dog from K-9?
With the movie with James Belushi?
Oh, that K-9, okay. I'd rather see K-9 fight Turner and Hooch in a tag match.
Okay, well, between those...
First of all, Turner and Hooch, I want to die. And that was the only part of that movie I liked when the dog died. That slobbering pig dog died. I take Lassie to win it all, and I'll tell you why. Lassie doesn't give up. Lassie never gives up. That dog, you could cut off three of its paws, it's still coming after you, dragging its red ass along.
If Benji, like, bit Timmy, oh, God, Lassie would go off.
All right, here's one for you, Fez.
All right, give.
Blade.
All right.
Who's badass.
Yes.
Versus Neo.
Ooh.
From Matrix.
I'm going with Blade. I'm going with Blade.
Let me check with Rory.
Rory, Blade versus Neo from Matrix.
I have to go with Matrix, without a doubt.
You call him Neo. You just don't call it the whole thing. Matrix is where he lives. Okay, he's a person.
That's like saying I go with Batcave.
The Matrix is everything. Where you eat, where you sleep. Fez?
Yes?
Here's the thing that you forgot when you picked Blade. Neo is not a vampire, my friend.
So Blade wouldn't fight him?
Neo is the one. He's the chosen one. He can't lose.
Oh, I see.
Blade, very good at killing vampires. And now those half-vampires, whatever those things were in Blade 2.
All right, let me throw this out. Blade versus Vampire from Brooklyn.
Give me Blade, and I wish you would kill him quick into that Vampire from Brooklyn.
Or Blackula.
Blackula or Vampire from Brooklyn.
Oh, okay, Blackula.
Yeah, Blackula.
Sure.
That goes without saying. Here's Mario. Mario, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Mario.
Riffs. Fellas, I got two for you. First, I want to kick one old school.
Mm-hmm.
My man, Matt Helm, against our man, Flint.
Wow, so you're talking James Colburn against Dean Martin, two of my absolute faves of all time.
You got to go with Dino.
Man, this is very difficult for me.
Come on, old.
I'm going to, you know what, give it to me to for Dean Martin, just for the great work that he did later with his variety hour.
Him
and those
wife.
Fine roasts?
Yeah, and with his great roast.
I just like when he used to jump out and the piano would collapse under him.
He's terrific.
I got a good one for you.
He's actually my favorite person in the Rat Pack, or Brat Pack, really.
Favorite? The only one that was worth it.
Come on. You're going to talk bad about Sinatra?
I can't stand Sinatra, man.
All right, that's it. I'm not going to sit here and take calls like this all night, okay? We're trying to have a nice, sophisticated conversation. But if you call here and you start making disparaging remarks about the chairman of the board... How the hell are Fez and I supposed to do a show?
Yeah, exactly. How are you even supposed to approach that? Try to have a nice open forum, a little debate.
Right. But I'm not going to sit here and listen to crazy talk about Mr. Sinatra.
877-692-1027 if you'd like to call in and play by the rules.
Is that so impossible? Fezzy, what about, we were talking about Gladiator?
Right.
What about Gladiator versus Spartacus?
Gladiator versus Spartacus. All right, I'm still going to go with Gladiator. I'm going to stick with Maximus.
Maybe you forgot Mr. Kirk Douglas, my friend.
I have not forgotten him. But I'm going with the Gladiator, Maximus.
I am Spartacus, my friend. Give me Spartacus. I don't know if I could ever bet against Kirk Douglas. Especially against an Australian? Hiding himself as a Spaniard? In an Italian movie. How does that even make sense?
He took a long way to Rome.
And out of all that nuttiness, they end up giving him an Oscar. With all that wackiness. Larry, you're on Ron Fez.
Larry, what's going on?
Yeah, how about St. Elmo's Fire versus Breakfast Club?
Ooh, wow. Now, is this a fight or just a fashion show?
No, it's a fight. It's
a dance-off.
Well, would that be... Is that a cat fight of all time?
All right, so you got Judd Nelson fighting on both sides.
You're right.
Yeah, but is he on the blow or not this time?
It does. I think the kid came out on the blow. Who would win that? Emilio Estevez and both.
Right.
Well, you know, your only real difference there is Demi Moore.
You got Demi Moore versus Molly Ringwald. You got Anthony Michael Hall versus Andrew McCarthy. As they match up, as they pair off.
One thing, though, you forgot, Rob Lowe. Get pretty tense in there.
That's right. You know what? You got Ali Sheedy also on both teams.
Right.
So it may come down to Scuba Suit versus Molly Ringwald. And at that point, I'd have to go with St. Elmo's.
The great Mayor Whittingham.
Right.
All right, there you have it. St. Elmo's beats Breakfast Club. And it's really just because they've outnumbered them. And, of course, they're allowed to drink.
Sure.
Because they had pot in Breakfast Club. And they proved their bravery standing up to their principal. No. Yes.
You want another? You want
yes.
Another? Fine, that's three. Want to try for four?
Yes.
All right, that's four. Want five?
Fine.
How about six?
Just stop.
You
no.
Just bought yourself a whole month.
No.
That Mayor Winningham put the ham in Winningham.
She wasn't even up that big. You just dive in at any chance to attack a woman. Here's Jay. You're on Ron Fez.
Hey, Jay.
How you doing, buddy?
Yeah.
Got a good one.
Yeah.
Jason Chong versus Jay and Silent Bob.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's
tough.
That's tough.
Yeah.
Give me Cheech and Chong.
Based on what, Fez?
Mexican.
I think if they're high, I think Cheech and Chong would win, though.
I'm going to put this to you. Just give you something to think about.
All right.
Cheech and Chong really don't work as a team that well anymore. And I don't think they ever really liked each other. I mean, the fact that Cheech is hanging around with Don Johnson...
I think that would piss them
all right,
off.
Now that I've had a chance to think it over, give me Jay and Silent Bob.
All right.
And I'm going to tell you something else. Kevin Smith's going for like, is like 340 right now.
And he's on Jay Leno.
He's slow.
I mean, how do you go from movies to Jay Leno?
I don't know. He's one of those guys that loves to be on TV, though, doesn't he? Kevin loves to be on TV.
Ronnie, this one, Black Earl asked me to ask the audience. Good Burger versus Disorderlies.
All I gotta say is, welcome to Good Burger. That was a great movie.
Welcome to Good Burger. Can I take your order?
All right, what about Fridays?
Okay.
Versus House Party.
Ooh. All right. With Debo, give me Fridays.
Oh, yeah, I didn't think of that. Yeah, that goes without saying. Of course, and also Fizz on Love.
Oh, that's right.
Big Worm.
Hey, Big Perm. Worm.
Here's Colin. You're on Ron and Fez.
Colin, what can we do for you?
Buddies.
Hey, buddy.
All right, I got two. First one, I'm really curious about. Clint Eastwood versus John Wayne. But Clint Eastwood from, like, High Plains Drifter type, Josie Wales type thing.
Well, not... pick a movie.
And what John Wayne are we talking about?
Yeah, any John Wayne Western. Like, you know, High Noon.
Why don't we just pick the Cowboys where he was 80 years old and riddled with cancer? You know, you have to be definitive here.
Exactly. These are the versus movies.
All right, fine. I got one more. Indiana Jones versus Alan Quatermain.
Now you're jumping ahead. We're already in one debate. The Duke versus Clint Eastwood. I'm going to say the same thing to you that Clint Eastwood would. This one goes to John Wayne. Because John Wayne never loses.
And Clint would be happy with that.
Whether he's happy or not, it's going to happen. Paul, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Paul.
Hey, guys, what's up?
Yeah.
Raging Bull versus Rocky.
First thing I would do is tell Jake LaMotta that Rocky banged his wife.
Me too.
You F my wife? You F my wife?
Hey, what about, remember John Wayne in The Quiet Man? Trump
right.
Thornton?
Yeah.
How about him
Sean
in Raging Bull?
Thornton. Nobody's going to beat Jake LaMotta when Robert De Niro was at his best.
Oh, Trump of Thornton, the best fight scene in all the movies ever.
It was a great, great movie, my friend. Put his name in the book and then strike a line through it. The Quiet Man, great, great movie. A fight that takes place over about a mile and a half. Two guys, cool old-style Irish fighters, fighting over a mile and a half. Then there's also that thing where they take a break and go in and drink at the bar. And he takes a big hit of Guinness and spits his tooth down on the bar.
The fight is just nonstop.
Let's take a break. We'll come right back. More of this intellectual talk with Ron and Fez.
Ron and Fez. 1027 WMEV. Ron Bennington. Fez Watley. In The Road to Perspiration.
It's too hot. I swear my nads just melted into my shoes.
Fez, maybe it wouldn't be so hot if you took off that big furry sweater.
What sweater? I'm topless.
Oh, my God. Ron and Fez's The Road to Perspiration. This film has absolutely nothing to do with Tom Hanks or Paul Newman.
We're out of Fez, 877-692-1027. Live on a Tuesday night. Now, one thing we've
Sorry,
tried to do...
I was away from the... I left Fezzy in here.
I thought all of a sudden I got that confused. What am I supposed to do? One thing we've been trying to do for the past couple days is talk Billy Staples out of this gig he's got coming up.
The beauty of we've got tickets to give out for Jim Norton. We were doing that happily, having fun with it. Except for now we found out Billy's going to be with him.
Now we're just cringing. Jim Norton, of course, he's going to be at the Count Basie Theater, Red Bank, New Jersey. It's this Saturday, August 10th. It's the Yellow Discipline Tour. Still a few tickets available at the Count Basie Theater box office and Ticketmaster. Sounds like a great show. Great night of fun and entertainment. Everyone loves Norton. Then we find out who's going to waddle out on stage to begin with. Billy Staples.
Billy, have you backed out of this gig yet?
No, not in the least. Matter of fact, I've been emailing Jim. We're both very excited about it. It's still a go.
Did you bore-ass him into getting this gig?
Not in the least. He came
because
up to me.
Because I'll be humiliated if I find out that you were just begging him to get on this bill.
Because I don't have to beg to get on a comedy show. My
you
goodness.
Never work in any comedy shows, ever.
I'm for only free on Saturday nights, and I work whenever I can.
Never. You work once a year when Paul gives you a gig.
That's not the way it is at all. I used to travel all the time before I had...
Do it now, then. If you're so funny, travel away from me and Fez.
Every other Saturday night, you're counting mustard packets with your mother.
That's only when I'm not working. No, before I had a regular job and stuff, I would travel all the time, all over the place.
Please, Billy...
You guys just have doubt because you haven't seen me. That's
how
the whole
far
thing.
Away
no, we've
did
never
you...
seen you. But I've seen you here, and you're never funny.
How about, look, I talked to Jim about this already, and he has no problem leaving a couple of tickets under your name at the will call window.
It would be
night.
Just the most embarrassing thing that ever happened to me.
You know what would happen if Ronnie and I went there? You would go out on stage, bomb, then we would actually have to face Norton in person that night and go, oh, my God, I'm so sorry. Why would Ronnie and I want to be part of that?
Being asked to show up to see you do comedy is like somebody saying, oh, I want you to show up and see your niece get raped.
I just want
to feel like I'd run out there
When's
and throw
that?
I'd throw a coat around you and try to bring you to the hospital.
I just want to look out from that stage and see you guys sitting like right in the front row, smiling from ear to ear because you think I'm going to go out there and die when the whole place is rocking and you guys are so surprised and pleased. That would be like the best.
You're saying you're going to rock the place.
I plan on it, and it's going to happen.
You're
going to
rock the Count Basie Theater on Saturday night.
Of course. I wouldn't be doing it.
What are you opening with?
Oh, I don't know yet. I'm saving all that for the show.
Well, come on. Do a little for our show.
Why buy the cow and eat the milk for free? Come on.
Be the guest comedian. Let's pretend you don't know me and Fez, and you've come on the show to plug this gig on Saturday.
Right, so you'd have to be a little bit funny here in order to get people interested enough to come out to Count Basie Theater in Red Bank.
Fez, we have a young comedian stopping in to do the show with us tonight.
Oh, great.
And we got a pair of tickets to give away at 877-692-1027. He's going to be opening up for Jim Norton, the big show we've been talking about.
Oh, that's right. It's the Yellow Discipline Tour this Saturday night, Red Bank, New Jersey, at the Count Basie Theater.
There's still a couple tickets available.
At the Count Basie Theater box office.
Mm-hmm. Also, Ticketmaster. Here comes a comic in. Roy gets headphones for him. He's from Long Island, local guy, Fezzy.
Nice. Local boy makes good.
And his name is Billy Staples. Hi, Billy. Welcome to Ron and Fez.
Oh, thank you, guys. It's really great to be here. Thanks for having me in.
No problem. Excited about the big show Saturday night?
Oh, almost as excited as I am about watching Britney Spears, man. That girl turns me on.
What?
Yeah, every time I see her, I watch one of her videos, I think I say, oops, I did it again more than she did.
So Britney, yeah. You like Britney.
Oh, so you're Spears fan.
I got one of her calendars, too. The only problem is March and April are stuck together.
From what?
How would that happen? Maybe you need to return it.
You don't mean you're...
Oh, yeah. Big fan, I said. Did I not mention I was a big fan?
Yeah,
She's 20.
Yeah, I know. Isn't that great?
You're how old?
44. It's a perfect match. I can show her all the things that she hasn't seen yet, you know? I'll pop that cherry.
Oh, my gosh. She just screamed, pop that cherry.
John, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
I'm going to kill Roy for booking these guests.
How you doing, boys?
Yeah.
Hey, John.
Listen, I wanted to beg, and I say beg the five Letterman, not to show up with Jimmy when he comes to Westbury. I'm married 15 years. I hardly ever go out, and when I go out, I want to have a good freaking time.
Well, I'm not doing Westbury yet, but it is my home turf. So it is my home turf. It's right around the corner.
I know that, Billy, and you got balls as big as King Kong, but you're not funny.
Oh, yes, I am.
Thank you.
I hope to do Westbury to prove it to you.
Oh, please.
Wait a minute, John. Before you judge him, did you have a chance to hear the Britney Spears, the dirty old man splooging the Britney Spears bit?
Did you hear that chunk?
I did, and it was not good. Not good.
All right, thank you, John. Here's Don. Don, you're on Fez.
Don, what's going on?
Hey, how are you guys?
Well, we're okay.
Listen, my birthday this weekend. Had full intentions of going and seeing Norton. It's your show on Friday night. Staples, you talked me out of it. Thank you very much.
Why would I talk you out of going out on your birthday?
Please, just listening to you. But how could you do that to me?
Hold on.
He's not even sure he wants to have another birthday now.
All right, don't worry. He's got more material, right, Bill?
Please.
No, that's all I'm prepared. I'm still working out.
That's
my
what
set.
You would do when you came to a radio show. You would do three bad Britney Spears jokes and leave?
Nah, well, just make sure you get your plugs in. That's what seems to be the rule.
You didn't even do that.
No.
Ronnie and I did.
No, believe me, we've had a lot of comics on the show before.
Mm-hmm.
And they, sit in with us, and they do comedy.
Well, the whole thing is, with Saturday night, it's going to be a perfectly worked out set, which I'm still working out the details on. I still got some time beforehand, so I'm just waiting to get the final okay and actually how much time I'm doing from Jim. But he's excited about it, and that makes me excited.
How about 60 seconds?
Oh, that would be way too short.
And how about other than doing a set, just make announcements?
There you go.
What time the refreshments are open till?
If someone left their lights on in the parking lot.
Where the exit signs are in case of a fire.
Ronnie, I'm not a stand-up announcer. I'm a stand-up comic. There's a big difference. I'm not going to make announcements at the show.
But if you were a comedic guest on our
show...
Why
don't you show up and throw out T-shirts?
There you go. Can you get one of those T-shirt cannons? People love those.
You're the new Melissa St. Jude. Here's Sean. Sean, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Sean.
Buddy, it's 15692.
All right, buddy.
Hoo-ah!
Hey, I live right near Red Bank. I work in downtown Red Bank. How can I get some of these Billy Staples tickets?
Now they're called the Billy Staples tickets.
Norton comes with it. I want to see Billy Staples. I want to be the official ambassador to the show and give you a review on Monday.
We don't want a review. Matter of fact, Fez and I have off Monday night, and we also have off Friday, Fez.
Yeah, we got a four-day weekend this weekend, just so I could get out of town as far away from this gig
I gotta
that Billy's going to ruin.
He bombs. Well, we know he's going to bomb. I'll let you know how badly he bombs.
All right, hold on, Sean.
I really don't want to hear about it come Tuesday.
I'm a little nervous about this, Billy.
Ronnie, you shouldn't be nervous in the least. Come on, have I ever let you down? Five Letterman,
yes.
Digstown, Paintballs.
Yes.
I've done it all
yes.
for you guys. I'm not going to let you down on stage.
That's not the same thing as going out and entertaining people with your wit.
That's easier. And a lot less painful.
All right, by the way, on the instant feedback.
Yeah?
I heard that Britney Spears joke on Comedy Central. He steals jokes.
Oh, great.
Did you really,
please,
Billy?
Never.
Did
absolutely
you steal that?
Not. Absolutely not. I do not steal anything. I never have and I never will.
The calendar joke, the oops, I did it again joke, both those things sound stolen.
No, not at all, because I used to do a whole Britney chunk in my act. But
all right, let's do the Britney chunk.
No, I don't. I haven't done it for a long time. That was the only two I remembered.
So there is actually...
Those were the only two on Comedy Central.
I resent the fact that I steal material. That's absolutely
you know
not
what I resent it, too.
You know what you ought to do for material is buy HBO.
Oh, I have HBO now at my mom's.
All right, let's hear the joke.
I don't have jokes from it. I just have HBO.
Oh, I thought that was a setup for a really...
Oh, no.
You just have BO.
No, I'm not going to do that stop joke. Hey, yeah, I'm going to...
Good one, Ron. But if you were the guest comedian on the Run and Fez show,
mm-hmm.
we would be able to bring up some things in the news, and you'd have your quick wit going. You'd be able to comment on some of the things in the papers.
All right, let's play. You remember that old show, Make Me Laugh?
Oh, God, yeah.
All right, let's play Make Me Laugh.
Oh, wait. Those guys had time to prepare.
You're a comedian. Billy, I swear.
Okay.
Here's Michelle. Michelle?
Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez.
Hi, Michelle.
I gotta see little Jimmy Norton, even though Billy Staples sucks and shouldn't be in Red Bank.
All right, let's do it this way. If you can go 1 minute without Billy making her laugh, we'll give you the tickets.
Piece of cake.
Now, Billy, on the other hand, if you can't make her laugh, maybe we call Norton and we bail out of this deal, okay?
No, it has nothing to do with whether Michelle laughs or not. The show is a done deal. I mean, so that's...
I know, but whether or not you can come back here after doing the show.
Oh, well,
because I don't want you to embarrass me and Fez.
I'm not going to embarrass you.
Just prepare yourself. You've got a couple seconds to prepare for Make Me Laugh with Billy Staples. Now, Michelle, remember, you've got to go the full 60 seconds.
Okay, I'm ready.
Without
I'm ready.
Laughing.
All right, we're going to be listening to you very carefully, Michelle, for snickers and guffaws.
Yeah, I think if we even hear a snicker.
All right.
All right, Billy, in 5 seconds.
I'm going to put the phone way high so we can hear every...
Billy, make Michelle laugh.
You know what, Michelle? You know what I can't stand? I cannot stand when you're watching, like, a cable TV show, and all these guys get everything done in a half hour. I mean, I can't even change a friggin' light switch without it. And I watch this one guy come on. What's his name? Christopher Lowell. He comes on like, oh, hello! How we all doing today? And this guy is sitting there. He'll make a new toilet seat out of a lampshade and spackle a wall white without using any spackle. And then the worst part is, and then he's going to BF the cameraman during the commercial or something. And then, ever see the one, Michelle, with the guy, and every week he's got a different blonde with him, and they can't even, like, hammer a nail into a wall without wearing protective eye gear? It's like, is this like when you do something at home with your spouse? No, not at all. It's like, honey, give me the screwdriver. I don't have it. Just give me the screwdriver. I don't have it. Don't yell at me. It's not my fault you hung the wallpaper upside down. I did not. Oh, yeah? Well, since one is one Mr. Bunny sniffing the other Mr. Bunny's ass? The worst, though, has to be the guy Norm from this old house. Norm from this guy.
Oh,
this is a good one.
Where?
I wanted you to have tickets, Michelle.
Was it funny?
No, I wanted you to have tickets.
Now, Michelle, if there wasn't tickets there, would you have started busting up laughing?
No. No way.
Do you think you'll be laughing in Red Bank during the opening act?
I'm going to wait for little Jimmy Norton.
Yeah, that's the smart
Norton's
thing
Norton's going to kill.
All right, hold on, Michelle. We're going to give you tickets.
Yay, thanks.
All right, Billy, you felt very good about this thing. Now you almost had her.
I was there, but you know what? I was glad she won, so I was, you know, holding a little back, I guess.
All right, we're going to play Make Me Laugh with Billy Staples again.
No, I can't keep doing Make Me Laugh, Ronnie. I need the material for the show.
It'll be fine, Billy. Although, I mean, you speak very fast. Probably you wouldn't wear it out so much if you paused maybe for a lap. All right, we're coming up to the top of the hour. This is going to be, let's go with line 9. I'll just smack at these lines, Fezzy.
All right, that's fair. Right.
You're on Ron and Fez.
Who's this?
Yes, this is Ellen.
Hi, Ellen.
Big Ass 4433.
Oh, nice to talk to you.
Hoo-ah!
Ellen, you excited about going to see the Billy Staples show if you get the chance?
I'll give him a chance, but I'm there for Norton.
That's great.
Everybody wants to see Norton.
Yeah. Now, Billy, see, this is one of the problems that Fez and I have with this. It's a reflection on our show when people want to see the guy from O&A's show, but not necessarily from our show.
Well, that's the whole thing. Jimmy's been out there. You know, Jimmy's the headliner, and I'm just there to, support and open up and get the crowd all warmed up and ready to go for Jimmy Norton.
All right, great. So you got 1 minute, Ellen.
All right.
Now, remember, you don't laugh. You get the tickets. But if you do, Billy will give you a parting gift.
Okay?
Right. I'm sure he'll give you the cash for the tickets. All right, here we go. We'll go wait up to the top of the minute here.
Okay.
Billy, you have 1 minute, 60 seconds to make Ellen laugh.
All right, Ellen. Hi, how are you today? Okay, very nice. You know what, Ellen? You know, being a married man, I hated the winter. Hated the winter with a passion. Because without a doubt, the minute winter came, my wife would stop shaving. The minute the sweaters came out, the razors went in. After a couple of weeks, I swear to God, she started to look like that forgotten piece of fruit in the back of the refrigerator. And you had to be like real careful when you go to bed at night when you're like half asleep. And she'd go like, good night, honey. And it'd be like, good night, Chewy. Oh! But I'll tell you, one thing worse about being married is my wife never trusted me on the road. Never trusted me on the road. She either thought that I got better looking or the audiences got blind or something. So she got me something that I would never cheat on her with and I would never get laid with. She got me a minivan. I don't care whether you're Brad Pitt or you're tucking in your sock or you're like me and you have both. You ain't getting laid in a minivan. And she even got me one that has a little sticker on the back that says, our child is an honor student. We don't even have a friggin' kid.
Ellen, you just
Thank
won.
Thank you for the ticket.
I did that for you, Ellen.
Thank you.
Ellen, how did you do it? How did you hold back just falling down in laughter?
I put the phone down.
Oh, that's cheating.
No.
That's cheating. Did you hear it all?
No, I heard it.
What did he do the jokes on?
His wife not shaving. Yeah. The bumper sticker on the car, and he doesn't even have kids. Awful.
Maybe, All right, Ellen, you're going to go see Jimmy Norton.
Thank you.
It's going to be a great show. Billy, it's starting to grow on me a little bit. I'm starting to pick it up, though, your rhythms.
Billy Staples, he won't be talked out of it. He says he's going to appear with Jim Norton on the Yellow Discipline Tour this Saturday night at the Count Basie Theater in Red Bank, New Jersey.
Now I'm getting excited.
Cool. I just don't want to give too much away in the air. People won't come, Ronnie.
Yeah, that's true. The more you do, the less chance you have of them coming.
I don't know. We keep giving away pairs of tickets for Make Me Laugh.
Yeah, tomorrow night we're going to play Make Me Laugh. You be ready for it, okay, Billy?
Okay.
Let's 40-second Delay says he has a song in your honor.
Cool.
Let's bring in 40-second Delay. We'll get him set up.
By the way, Billy, I'm going to be kind to you and not read one of the instant feedbacks.
Read one.
Not one.
Read one. My 40-second Delay is getting set up. Just for me. Whisper
it. Too mean.
Save them for me.
They're here, Fezzy. There's plenty of them.
Hey, 40-second Delay. How you doing, buddy?
What's up? Maybe I'll be able to channel these instant feedbacks into the song here.
Here's my favorite one. It says, Billy would have a better chance playing Make Me Cry. Other people are saying, why are you playing Make Me Puke? That's come up a few times. And get that guy a glass of water. Apparently they can tell that you were dry gulching yourself.
Yeah, you did a big cotton mouth during that last Make Me Laugh segment.
We all did. Oh, we all felt the moisture leave our mouths.
It was just very spur of the moment. I got called in here after 11.
I bet most of the people who were listening had their balls shrink. That's how painful it was. Like being in a fight.
You guys are being unnecessarily cruel about my comic abilities.
I feel like it's necessary.
Why?
No, I'm only kidding, Billy. You're starting to grow on me. All right, now a 40-second delay has written a song about you. This is nice.
Beautiful. Go ahead, 40-second delay and run it fast.
Billy's gonna open at the Norton Show. Assault the crowd at Red Bank with his jokes. It's gonna get ugly when they see he blows. And Billy gets scared on the stage until he chokes. Build a bomb, gonna bomb. Billy's gonna bomb. I love Billy's gonna bomb. Billy's bad, but Norton's great. So if I were you, I'd show up late.
Thank you.
There we go. Here's Andrew.
Are you going to come out to that, Billy?
That would be great.
No, and I wouldn't particularly take that advice either.
Is that your entrance music?
I'd get there nice and early.
Andrew, you're on Renefez.
Hey, I hope there's a flood. Hey, Andrew.
Hey, Billy, why don't you stick to what you know about? Talk about rehab.
Okay.
A couple jokes.
I just never found that particularly personally amusing. That was a dark part of my life, but...
You don't have a rehab chunk?
How about moving back in with your mom? There's a lot of jokes about that.
This is funny stuff.
Yeah. I told you I'm a funny guy.
No, it's the callers.
Oh.
But the five rehabs, moving back with your mom in your mid-40s.
Right.
It's all new stuff, so yeah.
Like if you do, will you go out there and you do the joke about your wife not trusting you. I mean, anyone who knows you from the show knows that you don't have a wife anymore.
Well, that's right. True. I mean, legally, yeah, but that did happen, so... I mean, that really did happen. So.
She really bought you a minivan?
Yeah.
To keep you from getting chicks on the road?
Oh, yeah, I'm quite the ladies' man when I was on the road.
This will be the heckles. You've never had your own vehicle.
Ronnie, don't prompt them, for God's sake.
Well, you never had a minivan.
Yeah, I did.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I had a Windstar. Ford Windstar.
Nice. Thanks for happening.
Yeah.
Wow, you are an interesting comedy guest. I wonder why we don't have more comedians on the show, Fez.
Wow.
Here's Sean. You're on Fez.
How you doing, Rockstar? Go ahead, Sean.
Billy, you could bring a dead corpse on the stage and get more laughs than you. Is that really your good material?
Are you going to try that? Bring a corpse out?
No, that's not really a fair thing to say. You've never seen me live. See me live. Come to the show.
We're live right here, Billy.
Hey, I'll be live. Ron and Fez, send me some tickets. I want to see Norton.
We're going to do this. We'll play Billy Will Make You Laugh tomorrow night.
Yeah.
Boy, is that false advertising. Billy Will Make You Laugh.
I don't know if I can go through another minute of it tonight without putting a gun in my mouth.
I thought it was growing on you.
I mean, like a tumor.
That's not a good way, is it, Billy?
Mush, you're on Renefez.
Mush.
Hello.
Yes.
How you guys doing?
Good, buddy. Go ahead.
If Billy goes on stage, the terrorists win.
That's true.
And you know what?
Oh, come on. That's a stretch, for God's sake.
Seriously.
Your pants are a stretch.
Do you know what made Billy not get laid on the road?
What's that?
His stand-up act.
The same reason why he couldn't get laid in Long Island.
Yeah, I was married.
Yeah, well, you're not married now, big man.
No, it's going to happen. Going to unleash the hounds.
You're going to unleash the hounds. I'm sorry. How many do you have?
Literally. He'll unleash the hounds. He's going to have dogs eat women.
How many dinks do you have?
Oh, just one. It was just a metaphor, kind of speaking.
Mark, you're on Renefez.
Hey, Mark.
What's going on, guys? Hey, Billy, I need your address so I can send you my tickets. I want my money back after hearing this crap that you're putting out.
All right, now hold on. The rest of the show is going to be fine.
Yeah.
You cannot blame Norton on the fact that as a funny practical joke, he's having a retard open for him.
Well, I guess we'll just hang out outside for an extra half
He
hour.
Tried to get that Life Goes On kids banned, but apparently Billy was the only one available, not Corky.
Why don't you just come out as Corky?
Why would I do that? Well, I'll just come out as myself.
Act like you're that girl comic from Facts of Life.
Why, I don't have a disability. Why would I pretend to have a disability?
Billy, promise me this. This week you will make someone laugh.
Oh, I'm definitely going to make a whole room full of people last Saturday night.
I mean, on the air.
Ronnie, you got people in their cars dying right now, for God's sake. Probably having to pull over
or
something.
Yeah, they've run the hose inside from the exhaust.
I mean, it's only the people who get the opportunity to call who don't appreciate it. Look, do you think Jim would have me if he didn't appreciate my abilities and know what a funny guy I am and what a good stand-up?
What is he up to? What kind of mean Carrie prank is he pulling? Is pig's blood going to fall on Billy when he goes out there?
Billy's going to get covered in blood on Saturday night at Count Basie.
Nope. Not going to pull a William Cat and have any blood on him.
Is this just the two of you?
Not really sure. I know Jim had originally mentioned something about Voss if he was available,
well,
too.
This is good news for Voss. Voss will actually be coming out to thunderous applause.
They won't be able to wait to see him. Billy, you know no details about this gig that's coming up this Saturday night.
Well, I've only communicated with Jim through email because they've been off for a while.
Because
so.
He's not speaking to you.
Have you talked to him in real life? Maybe it's somebody playing a mean AOL prank.
Yeah, maybe someone, what do they call that, shadowed his email or something?
No, this was an actual, I can recreate the moment for you. We were right in front of the mailboxes, and we were talking about the show, and he goes, yeah, do you want to do a spot?
And it went something like this, as Billy musses his hair and comes back to act out.
You doing any impressions?
No. No impressions.
Wow. I heard a great Christopher Lowell earlier.
Sounded just like his wife.
Which one?
When you did the impression of your wife.
No, I meant which wife?
I have no idea, Billy. Just
when you did that last Make Me Laugh, I don't even know why I'm explaining it. Your Christopher Lowell voice was the same as the wife voice in the other joke.
Really? I see a delicate difference there. You know, I did see, I noticed a difference.
I will do them both.
I see a bomb on Saturday night.
Christopher Lowell was like, oh, hello, everybody. You know, and the wife is just like, hand me the screwdriver.
Now, you're married to a gay man?
You did not do that voice.
And you're married to a gay man?
No, not in the least. I'm not married to anybody right now.
But you did the whole, hand me the screwdriver, like when people do gay humor.
No, it's just like a female thing.
All right, what female talks like that?
This is so bad!
What female talks like that?
Can you answer, Ronnie?
Oh, most of the ones I've been around. That's where I got the voice from.
What's Norton Payne?
We haven't talked money.
I will double it.
You know no details.
I will double it now, whatever he's paying you, if you promise not to go.
I'll chip in on that.
Absolutely not.
Triple it if you promise never to do another show anywhere.
Did you say triple?
Yes.
No.
Oh. Please, take the money and stay off of a stage.
No, it's not going to happen. The stage, I love the stage. I love making people laugh, seeing the smiley, happy faces and stuff when you're up there and people applauding for you. It's like a
rush. Then play Santa Claus at Macy's Santa Land.
I tried that.
All right, here's Voss on the line. Panther Boy, you're on the air. How you doing, pal?
Hey, Voss.
What's happening? Oh. Hey, Billy, do not take this abuse. Just go out there and prove yourself.
Of course, Rich.
Hey, Billy, don't worry. And plus, I'm hosting the show, so you have someone warm up for you.
Oh, jeez.
Cool. So you're definitely doing the show then, Saturday,
all
too.
All right. All this proves is that Voss is in on the practical joke. They're playing on the big fat retard.
No, the show. I work
Richard, it's not funny. It's not funny what you're doing.
Doing
seriously.
Nothing.
Huh? And do you also have a girl for him, and you want her to kiss him, and then you're going to say, oh, Billy, she's pregnant now?
At what point do you steal his bike?
We've all teased the retard before, Richard. We should be out of that.
But there's no need to ruin the Red Bank show because of it.
No, Billy's going to do well. Just as long as he wears his helmet, everything will go well.
See, that's not funny.
See, Richard, you and I have been through the trenches together. We performed in some dumps together, so you know what it's
still
like.
There. Oh, you're still there, Billy. He's moved on.
You're still dump level.
Where did you appear last week? No one ever even heard of it.
Oh, what was that place we did together down in Jersey, Rich?
No, I'm talking to you,
buddy. Last weekend.
Oh, the place was Brooklyn's in Long Beach.
Why can't you follow the conversation tonight?
It was Brooklyn's down in Long Beach.
I don't know. I worked with Billy one time somewhere down somewhere, and he did a fine job.
As did you.
Yeah, well, that goes without saying, stupid. I thought you did very fine. And he went on before me, and
kill.
Boy, did I shine after that.
Sure.
Oh, God, did I kill.
All right, Bill, Richard, what's your favorite Billy Staples line that you're always repeating to your friends? Saying, oh, man, I heard a great line.
My favorite one?
Yeah.
Good night.
Ours, too.
No, hey, Billy,
Richard,
I didn't call this. Billy, I didn't call in the trash. I called in to stick up for you.
Thanks, Rich.
Sometimes people can take abuse on the radio, but all you do is go out and prove yourself.
And that's what I plan on doing. I am so confident for Saturday, and this even makes me more confident with this call, Richie. Thanks, man.
And you know what? The over-under is only 3 minutes that you last.
That's fine. I mean, because if you if 3 minutes, you get a big laugh. Good night. Thank you.
3 minutes, you're on longer than Paul.
Well, look, guys, I'm on the run.
All right.
How's it going, Fez?
I'm just saying don't do this, Richard Voss.
All right, I have nothing to do with it. I'm just hosting the show.
Don't tease the retard.
It's going to be a fine show. And I worked with Norton Atlantic City. He killed. Everything was, it was great shows. And adding Billy to this show, I think it's just going to power it up. It's just going to make it, you know, stupendous.
All right, thanks a lot.
Rich, I'll see you Saturday.
Bye. All right, bye.
God, here's what's going to happen. I mean, it's so obvious. They might as well print the headline now. People are going to walk away from that show. Norton kills. They're going to be thrilled. Voss is huge. And they're going to say, you know what part of the show I hated? That Ron and Fez part. I couldn't stand
Billy,
that Ron and Fez
says
part.
That.
Absolutely not.
That was really bad.
Wait, there's a man who's seen me perform, has worked with me, and has the utmost confidence. So maybe that could shake off and, you know, give me a little confidence from in the studio here and have a little belief in me.
Ronnie and I work with you every day. You've never made us smile.
Seriously, not once.
Well, you guys are a tough audience. You know, it's like there's a comedy club and then there's an office. It's very difficult, you know to make you guys laugh.
Why? Fez makes me laugh every day.
Thank
Hulk
you, Ronnie.
Hulk makes me laugh.
Hawk makes you laugh.
Yes, I'm always laughing at Hawk.
Well, Hawk does have a unique
quality
to him.
I'll tell you this. I'll do this. I'll pay Hawk to replace you, Billy.
Nice.
I don't think that's really your call, Ronnie. I think it's Norton's call. And Jim Norton wants me on the show this Saturday at the Count Basie Theater in Red Bank.
But God. Why? Why is he doing this?
Norton's not getting back from vacation until Thursday, right?
I really don't know.
You don't know anything
I
about
I just know
this.
I'm going
to
be there.
Know. You seriously, you have to start to know things about your own life.
Oh, we've been emailing me. I didn't ask him when he's coming back from vacation. I'm just going to see him Saturday night.
All right, let's play one more time and make me laugh.
Oh, no, that's
one
tomorrow
more
night.
Minute.
That's tomorrow night.
One more minute.
That's tomorrow night.
One more, Billy.
All these people want to win tickets, Billy.
You can do it.
Of course, Norton believes in you. Voss believes in you.
They just retards.
Although, I felt better if Voss would have remembered one joke.
Well, Rich works a lot, so he works with a lot of different people. I don't hold it against him. Not in the least, so.
Your act's that forgettable.
No, it's just, you work with a lot of people. You know, working in the comedy business, you see a lot of people.
All right, just on the instant feedback. Billy is a dick, and he's never funny, from Jersey Rich.
Oh!
Well, at least I'm in the friggin' band, aren't I?
You're not in the
band. I'm going to be at the Ronnie Festival
of
Rock and Ribs, I meant.
You're not in the band.
No, but I'm going to be at the festival, and he's going to be outside looking in like a kid on Christmas morning who doesn't get a friggin' toy.
Well, what kids have to look in on Christmas morning?
Why do kids, just because their families can't afford toys, also put them outside the house?
No. Little kids look into, like, the store windows who don't have enough money to buy toys with that sad look on their face.
I made up the Jersey Rich thing, and yes, he is still in the band.
No, he's not in the band.
Not.
I kicked him out. He has not apologized.
I made that up. He never said it.
No, he said it.
No, I just told you he didn't.
Oh, originally, but he still made his original comments, which got him kicked out of the band. So
his original comment was, please let Ron and Fez make the announcement of the location and date of Rock and Ribs.
What, did we have somewhere to go?
Because it was 50 minutes late while you were screaming about, what was it that night, your daughter or whatever, you were fighting with callers.
Well, you know what, Jersey Rich, your show goes to 11. Sit tight and listen. We'll get to mentioning the Ron and Festival Rock and Ribs soon enough for you. There was issues that had to be dealt with in the studio.
You're not doing jokes about your daughter Saturday night,
absolutely
are you?
Not.
All right. I'm just wondering. If you were, I might want to go.
No.
All right. Are you ready to play Make Me Laugh?
No.
Come on, Billy.
No, I'm going to do it tomorrow night when it's ready to go. Because tomorrow night, these people, they're all calling up now. They want tickets. They got to come back tomorrow night.
Give us one more 60 seconds. All right? One more. And we promise it's done tonight.
Look at him.
Right now.
He's bright red. He's got nothing. He's got squat.
How much time did you do at Long Beach last week?
Oh, half hour.
Any punchlines anywhere in?
Of course.
All right, you've only done 2 Make Me Laughs. You should have 28 more minutes to go here.
Yes, but a lot of it is visual and doesn't portray over the radio as well. And it's not a fair representation of my abilities.
This is what Norton will be saying when he's watching Billy from the Wings.
He has no business being out there! No business! Terrible!
Scott, you're on Ron and Fez.
Yeah, how you doing, guys?
Yeah.
Hey, Billy, is it true you're going to close with a Dickie Goodman bit?
Where's Billy's Dickie Goodman bit? Do we still have that? You want to talk about something that is so far from being funny. Billy tried to become the new Dickie Goodman. First of all, he tried to write this bit acting like we didn't know who Dickie Goodman was, so it would seem like it was original.
Oh, absolutely. Well, Dickie Goodman was my hero. I just didn't think you guys were that in tune to, like, the
Jaws.
What,
you think my parents never owned a radio?
Billy trying to revive the Dickie Goodman format. What he did to change it up, Ronnie, was, remember the Connie Chung interview with Gary Condit?
Yeah.
He kept the Connie Chung questions.
Yeah.
And then all of Gary Condit's responses were, of course, in popular songs of today.
And tomorrow, and yesterday.
What?
The songs, the song spanned a vast era.
All right.
And tomorrow, so tomorrow's hits?
Today.
Yeah. Let's listen to that.
Here's Billy Goodman.
Congressman Condit, do you know what happened to Chandra Levy? Did you have anything to do with her disappearance? Did you kill Chandra Levy?
Wasn't me.
May I ask you, was it a sexual relationship? Was Chandra Levy in love with you? Were you in love with her? Did she want to marry you and have your child? Did you ever make promises to her? But aren't you here to set the record straight?
That she's back in the atmosphere.
Would you like to tell the truth about your relationship with her? Why don't we talk about the last time you met with Chandra Levy? That was at your apartment. Correct me if I'm wrong. April 24th. There has been talk about a possibility that Chandra Levy was pregnant. Do you know if she was pregnant?
Wasn't me.
Did she tell you she was pregnant?
Wasn't me.
Did you kill Chandra Levy?
Wasn't me.
We have just a few minutes left. What has all of this done to you and your family?
I lost my kids and wife because I got high.
What do you think happened to Chandra Levy?
I used to love her, but I had to kill her.
Can you survive? Can your career, your marriage survive this? Do you think you're a moral man?
Wishing and hoping and thinking and praying, planning and dreaming.
The only solace we have here is Chandra Levy cannot hear that bit. Because fortunately for her, unlike the rest of us, she's dead.
Oh, is it bad?
Boy, does that stand the test of time. That is, I tell you, that even gets cleverer and wittier and funnier every time I hear it, because you appreciate it a little more.
All right, let's play Make Me Laugh with Billy Staples.
No, Ronnie, you said tomorrow night.
All right, Billy, let's do this. Either you do a Make Me Laugh, or you cut a Dickie Goodman bit for us, and no one.
All right,
by the end of the show.
I'd be glad to. Glad to do a Dickie Goodman bit for you.
All right, then tomorrow night you're going to play Make Me Laugh for the Norton tickets.
Absolutely. Going to make this
up. Now, did you ask if your name would go up there with Norton's on the... Is it now a Norton Staples gig?
Oh, no, absolutely
not. Are you guys going to flip to see who headlines?
Absolutely not. It's a Norton gig, and I'm just there to support it. And,
are you on the marquee?
No, I don't care about those kind of things.
Why?
I'm just there to go and make the people laugh. That's where I get my...
Promise me, if it doesn't come over, you won't come back.
Oh, I'll be back. Show. I'll be back.
Why won't you promise anything good?
That is good. That's very good that I'm coming back. You just won't see me right away, but I'll be back.
The horror hits the stage this Saturday night in Red Bank, New Jersey, the Count Basie Theater. Please do not just take Billy as the example of this show. Norton is going to kill that night. It's going to be a great Jim Norton show.
All right, the instant feedback. Jersey Rich says, the only way Billy could get a laugh, he comes out with a dog's D in his mouth.
And Jersey Rich would know about having a dog's D in his mouth.
All right, come on.
Because how else would he know that's funny, that stupid little unfunny prick?
Cut it out.
Okay.
What do you mean? No, here's a guy who would sit there and just plucks a bass in a garage band, for God's sake.
Billy, he didn't say it. I made that up, all right? Get off him.
Why?
Leave him alone.
He still ticked me off Monday. That doesn't stop. He's out of the band. He's not even coming to the festival.
It was a week ago Monday.
I had 40-second delay is in the band. Is Jersey Rich still in the band?
Yeah, and since when can you kick people out of our band? I don't understand this.
That's true. It's their band. It's not our band, but
right.
Let alone yours.
But it's our show.
No,
it's not our show.
And just because
it's our show.
And just because this is our show doesn't mean we tell people what to do in their band.
Yes, but they're performing on our show, on our stage, on our night. So we do have a say.
Oh, by the way, Billy will lose it if you guys say higher at any point in the song. And he'll pull you. All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, Billy, how long before you can do your new Dickie Goodman?
What time? Give me an hour.
An hour.
An hour. All right.
And this time I want you talking on it, too.
Oh, I'd be glad to. I'd love to do that.
All right. You're the interviewer on this one. I'm not even going to ask you who your subject matter is going to be.
This, on Instant Feedback, Jersey Rich is the bass playing what Billy wishes he were to comedy, and that's from Carter.
Whoa! Carter from RockFest.net scores!
Yeah, Carter. Look at that.
Carter scores.
Carter, what do you know about my comedy?
We got to take a break. We'll be back. It's Ron and Fez.
Ron and Fez. 1027 WAW. Ron Bennington, Fez Watley in The Road to Nutrition.
Ronnie, can I get cheese on that?
Fez, it's a bowl of cereal.
Good call. A little mayo, too, please.
Ron and Fez's The Road to Nutrition. This film will never open in theaters anywhere.
We're out of Fez. 877-692-1027.
Billy Staples in the other room now working on his Dickie Goodman bit of the night, Fuzzy. Should be ready within the hour.
So it'll be very exciting. Billy, of course, tomorrow night is going to make people laugh. Make me laugh for tickets to the Norton Show in Red Bank, New Jersey at the Count Basie Theater this Saturday.
Well, now it's being called the Norton Staples Show.
Really?
The Staples Center. This is how to take place at.
Staples Rehab Center. Now, one thing I'd like to know, I probably need a spy report from the audience. I want to check on how the Harlem All-Stars did in the Mid-Atlantic Little League Series.
And how old are these kids? It's not going to be another year we get behind some New York kids.
And they turned out to be in their 20s?
Yeah.
I think these are the actual 12-year-olds that supposed to be. So it's the Harlem All-Stars. They were taking on a team from New Jersey today. So they need to advance to get to that Little League World Series tournament. Right now, they're competing in the Mid-Atlantic.
What are you trying to do, win the East?
I guess that's eventually what you do. They win this Mid-Atlantic thing, maybe they move on to the East tournament and then to the World Little League Series?
Yeah.
That makes sense. Now, speaking of children, Ronnie, ABC, they've got a great new show out. It's called ICU. And what it is, Ronnie, it's sick kids. They're actually showing emergency rooms, real emergency rooms, working on real sick kids.
You're effing with me.
No. They're actually going to, they go to this ICU in Arkansas where there's kids there that have been in accidents, had diseases, problems. They're just going to follow them around with cameras. This is the latest in reality television. Actual sick kids, and they're calling this entertainment on ABC.
Who would ever want to see sick kids?
I can't imagine.
We got a
spy report. Spy report.
Coming up here, here's Scott. Scott, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez.
Hi, Scott.
Yeah, I got the spy report on the game.
Yeah, hold on.
Spy report.
Yeah, the Harlem All Stars won. Giambi hit 2 home runs.
No, that's a different team. Wise ass.
We were asking about the Little League team.
I have a good feeling about these kids, though, Fez.
This would be nice. The Harlem All-Stars go all the way. It was fun last year, but then it turned out, you know,
some of the boys are older.
The Baby Bombers weren't babies. One of them wasn't a baby. He was shaving. 877-692-1027. Now, Ronnie, this ICU show on ABC, one of the episodes, this is actually how it plays out. They start out showing a home movie of a little boy playing baseball, running the bases. He could be a Harlem All-Star. He's running around. He's having a good time. That footage cuts to him in his hospital bed where he's taking his last breath.
Who would want to see this show?
This is absolutely bizarre. They cut to the hospital bed where the boy's face is gray and puffy. And then his mother describes the moment his heart stopped. This is the worst show ever.
At least the worst show ever.
So it's a new, it's a four-part ABC News series on a pediatric cardiac care unit in Arkansas, I believe.
And how are we supposed to feel? Happy? How is this a good show?
Now, there is another story where an infant saved by a transplant. That's to cheer us up from the little leaguer who just died. That's to get our spirits back up.
Awful.
This is sick, ABC. No one's going to want to watch sick kids. What's your next project? Baby burn unit? Tuesdays this fall?
Notice as the kid's skin comes up. We'll be right back after this break. No one wants to watch that.
With more baby burn unit.
I'm sorry we couldn't save your baby. All right, this on the instant feedback from ADF. What about the leukemia little ones?
Nice.
Just a little leukemia, kids.
Sure. Why not? Put it on the show, ABC. Put it on the tube. The executive producer, he actually says, this is the way life is. Bad things do happen to wonderful people.
Right. Who wants to see it? I mean, I don't want to see adults in having this happen, let alone kids.
ABC ought to just bring this up for their whole fall campaign. Bad things happen to wonderful people this fall on ABC.
How about amputees? Where we're watching 12 and 13-year-old kids trying to walk on their own stubs. Yes, those things happen.
The amputees. A new drama from ABC. It's right after Dial M for Mongoloid. As we just look at some retard kids.
No one wants to see this.
The reality stuff has gone too far, especially with ABC. Actual kids that are hurt.
How about toddler head wounds? Where you're just seeing kids fall when they're trying to learn how to walk.
They got a new show coming out on ABC. It's called My Tumor Hurts.
Ouch.
That might even be a sitcom. I'm not sure. It's too hard to tell with ABC.
Ouch, my tumor hurts. What is wrong with ABC?
What's the next project? Show called Kids, Cars, and Collisions? That'll be fun. Watching kids get hit by the mail truck.
All right, Ken C. says, what about the abortion puppets? And then Sheepy adds with, how about Stillborn Bonanza?
Thank you, Sheepy. I heard the president yesterday was talking about some law he wants to put into effect in case the fetus is born alive during the abortion. What rights it has.
They can drive a car, sure.
It will be eligible to vote. 877-692-1027.
Jim, you're on a Fez.
Hey, Jim, what can we do for you?
How's it going, guys?
Yeah.
How about the Toddler Trauma Center?
The Toddler Trauma Center, sure.
It's basically what they're doing on ABC.
Here's Mike. Mike, you're on Iran Fez.
Hey, Mike.
Yeah, Fezzy touched on this one. I think ABC is calling it the amputinis.
The amputinis.
Or just, the fetus friends is the other one. I'm not sure.
Just the cute kids.
Sure. I have a show called Preemies. They're fun.
Here's one from Larry. SID kids. These aren't good shows, Fezzy.
No, ABC should know this. Nobody wants to show up, turn on their TV, and watch a little leaguer die of a heart attack.
Here's one from McLean. Internal growing pains. Maybe ABC would like to get behind that. Internal growing pains.
Ouch. Why not just something called Three Blind Toddlers? Three blind toddlers out on the streets.
Bill, you're on Manifest. I'm not watching these shows.
I don't blame you.
Hi, Bill.
Hey, how about the Ebola babies?
Ebola babies from
Ebola
Africa.
Ebola babies. They take the film crews to the Dark Continent.
Rob, you're on Manifest.
Rob, what can we do for you?
What's up, guys? Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Oh, stop fooling around here.
You know this is a live show.
It's a live show. We're talking about Ebola babies. Just a mother crying and trying to shake a rattle over it.
Oh, God. What about baby boomer brain tumors?
Well, they would be older if they're baby boomers. I don't think you understand the whole baby boomer thing.
Not at all. But maybe they could make it into a game show of Who Wants a New Heart? Where kids
Pick
could be...
me. Pick me, please.
The children competing against each other.
Please, sir, can I have a heart?
They actually said on this show, ICU, new on ABC, just a nice show about real-life sick children, that they're going to run a list of pictures at the end of the show.
Sure.
Just pictures of kids across the country that are awaiting organs.
Great. Next week, born without bladders. Watch them turn yellow and bloat.
Sometimes I feel that way.
Rich, you're on a Fez.
Hi, Rich.
Hey, guys. Happy New Year.
Stop it, Rich.
It's a live show.
You know it. You know it.
My show is the Merc Baby Swim Patrol.
See, that they're fast. They're quick. And last night, Fez, you even said you love otters.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you what. The hands come right out of the shoulders. There's no arm involved.
They just go. It's like the speed is like seeing a torpedo.
Exactly. They just got those flippers and the speed at which they can move.
I would love to see a Merc Baby in a tuxedo and see if people thought it was a penguin. Jimbo, you're on Ron and Fez.
Probably be on ABC. Hi, Jimbo.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy.
Buddy.
Hey, how about the Spina Bifida Bunch?
See, I don't want to see that show. It's another show, Fezzy. It's actually more sad than anything.
That's true. But I guarantee you someone from ABC is listening to this show right now and just jotting down ideas for shows.
Brian, you're on Ron and Fez.
Brian.
Yeah, next big hit, Crib Debt Theater.
See, again, Fez, wouldn't that be sad?
The folks at ABC, they think that's a big hit.
Larry, you're on Ron and Fez.
Larry.
How about Surgical SpongeBob and Scrub Rats?
So thank to try you, to get the kids to watch
sure.
shows about sick kids.
Actually, when I'm saying that SpongeBob, I feel like it's a painful child death. I don't know
SpongeBob.
I've missed it, Fez, and I like to think I have a good sense of humor. And I sit there with my kids and I say the same thing. It's not funny.
And it's huge. People are loving it across the country. I said it 3 years ago. Watch out for this SpongeBob.
Why?
I don't know what's so good about it.
I want to sit next to you when you watch it once. I've seen three of them now, and I just don't laugh.
You'll have to be at my house Saturday mornings at 10, and I'll be in my underpants.
No. I don't want to see that. Here's Tom. Tom, you're on a Fez.
Hey, Tom.
Tommy, can you hear me?
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy.
Shake it up.
All right, shake it up.
How can I be mean? Shake it up.
Happy Easter, by the way.
It's a live show, Tom, and you know it.
So stop it.
Yeah, I wanted to let you know there's another show on ABC a little after that that's going to be about kids raised in the wild. It's called Babies with Rabies. See ya!
That's nice. We'll get the up-close footage of watching the babies get those stomach shots.
Here's Jimmy. Jimmy, you're on Ron and Fez.
Jimmy.
What is?
Hey, buddy.
19331.
All right.
Hoo-ah!
Well, I'm here to bring him back the Wheel of Misfortune and the Merv Griffin Savant Showcase.
See ya!
All right, they can't all be gems, big man.
Yeah, you try, buddy.
But if you know you don't have one, don't clog up the lines. Because we'll get people like Chuck D calling. Chuck D, you're on around the fence.
Yeah, I'm saving the show. Yeah. I got two. The emergency romper room.
Okay, I love
there
it.
There you go, Chuck
yeah.
D.
Or we got the Progeria Kids Happy Good Time Fun Wacky Hour.
Very funny, see? Thanks for saving the show.
I was going to warn Chuck D, stop at one. You hit it. You know, you were there.
No.
But no, he went for it, and it paid off.
It's two for Tuesday with Chuck D.
Worth the risk.
Is that the same Chuck D from Public Enemy? Check and see, would you?
I think it is.
Kevin, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Kevin.
Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez.
Hi, Kevin.
New show. Gather the kids around Saturday mornings. Down Syndrome Sandbox.
That one I might tune into.
He's got the pail on his head.
Actually, what they ought to do is get Hugh Downs from 2020.
Yeah.
And just do Hugh Downs Syndrome, where he just takes a look at retarded children. In a really bad way.
Maybe it's Hugh Downs Syndrome, but he and his wife try to have babies at this age.
Oh, God. You're just begging for an extra chromosome at that age when you try to have children.
Even if it's a male, though?
Yeah, I think so.
So one of these guys that's like 70s, they shouldn't have a baby?
I would say probably not.
Because I've never heard of that before.
Where the older male screws it up?
Yeah.
Like these Tony Randalls and Larry King.
Yeah, they seem like they always come out of it. You know, Imus, they all have nice, healthy kids. Where quarterbacks, on the other hand, not as lucky.
Good point. The Quarterback Kids, a new show on ABC. Bring out Dan Marino, Jim Kelly, Boomer Esiason. Just parade them all.
Isn't that twisted and weird?
It's bizarre, isn't it?
And what about the guy from Buffalo?
Yeah, oh, no. Jim Kelly.
No, the other. I'm thinking of the other one, the guy who replaced him, the little guy.
Oh, Flutie Flakes.
Flutie Flakes, yeah.
That's right.
He's out in San Diego now, and I don't know how many retarded kids he has. Mark, you're on
the
phone.
He needs to quit having them. Hey, Mark.
What's up, buddy? 6310.
Yeah. And yeah, Tony Randall, safe, happy baby.
Weird. Never threw a ball in his life.
Mark, you're on the Fez.
Listen, what's up, guys? I hear they're putting a new twist on an old show that's called Infant Strokes.
They're having infant strokes. Thanks, Mark. We want to look into this, too, Rory, after we're done with this comedy pyramid. Is there any danger to the baby if the father's older? Like one of these 90-year-old guys having kids.
Like, I had a friend's mom, and she was really old. She was she had 9 kids altogether, and the last two, you know, she had when she was probably well into her 40s.
Uh-huh.
You know, and the last two, one has a mental disability.
Right.
The other one, the last one, he's got a major heart defect.
Now, the...
But is it effective, like, when the mother is young, but the dad is real old? Is that affected at all? Like the Larry Kings and Tony Randalls we talked about.
Tony Blair's wife had a miscarriage today.
Really?
Yeah, 47.
Oh, gosh.
47. They just had a baby 2 years ago.
Right, I was going to say, don't they just have a kid?
Yeah.
Huh.
They can't wrap it over there, I guess. Mo, you're on Ron
Fez. What's up, buddy? Happy
Chinese
New Year.
It's not. It's a live show. You know it, Mo. You could help us instead of working against us.
Yeah, I'm a wise ass. I'm sorry. 917, no checking in.
All right, buddy.
Hoo-ah!
Gracias, buddies. I got 2 guys, a girl, and a stillborn on ABC.
See, that's a show I don't think people would like. I think it'll bring it down.
It's an awful show, and this new actual show on ABC, ICU, where they just take the cameras into critical care units and put them on sick kids.
Now, wouldn't you rather have your kids see breast jokes and ass jokes than stumble across this show?
And think, all right, let's say some little kid's watching the show where they have the little leaguer who dies from a heart attack.
Hey, Fezzy, first of all...
White people are so scared.
I don't
black people.
Care what color the child is. I don't think they should die from heart attacks.
I said little leaguer.
White people are so scared of black people.
Leaguer! Leaguer!
With an L?
Yes!
I got problems with my headphones.
Not an N, an L.
Gotcha.
Thank you. Now a kid's going to see that. He's going to be afraid to go out and have baseball.
Just so freak out knowing that...
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Yeah, I heard Fox is ripping them off with their own show. It's called Chemotherapy Kindergarten.
See, that's no one wants to see Chemo Kindergarten.
No. No one's going to watch Chemo Garden. It's an awful, awful show.
Here's Sean, you're on Ron and Fez.
Sean, what's going on?
Buddies, I got 2 for you.
Yeah.
I got Biopsy Buddies.
I like that one.
And Sid's Kids.
Oh, that's good. Down the wall. That's high date, Jeff.
Sid's Kids.
All right, thanks. Bill, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Bill, go ahead.
Hey, guys. 12155.
All right, buddy.
Hoo-ah! There's your hoo-ah, pal.
Yeah, well, here's one that NBC's bringing back an old favorite that I hear, the Milton Moyle Show, where they follow Milton with the cameras from brisk to brisk.
All right, thank you very much.
He's one of our older callers.
Terry, you're on Manifest.
Hey, Terry.
Hey, boys. 19587.
What can we do for you, Terry?
What about kidney transplant?
See, I don't want to see that. I think it would be sad, and I think it would scare children if they stumble across it.
Go ahead, Terry.
Oh, but you can have it hosted by, like, you know, like the Widow Mantle or something, you know? Oh.
All right, thanks, Terry. Here's some on the instant feedback. How about 2 kids, a car, and a crippling accident?
Just awful. And it'll probably be on this fall.
Sean says, how about them on ABC forming a boy band called the Bubble Boys?
They ought to go with Polly O-Town.
Polly O-Town.
O-Town. Cripple kids in Florida start a singing group.
Can you still even get polio?
I think it's making a comeback. That'll be another thing we check into.
So Polio Town, that's my favorite, I think, so far. Because they're singing.
Kids in wheelchairs.
How about Suddenly Infant Death Syndrome? And Brooke Shields can star.
Oh, all right. From Suddenly Susan.
Tom says AIDS is enough.
Aw.
Toddlers with Tourette's has come up.
All of these things, I'm sure the ABC network would be open to. If they're going to put this ICU show on, a news documentary show, where it's showing kids dying in emergency rooms.
Sparky says, fatality feud, which is kind of cute. And Private Pyle says, whose flat line is it anyway? So people are thinking, Fez.
They're working on this. They see the future of television on ABC.
Alter Ego says, Heart Murmur Munchkins would be cute.
Someone's killing me.
Johnny B, you're on Ron and Fez show.
Johnny, go ahead, Johnny B.
Hey, 11 p.m. Eastern time on Friday, ABC's got Crack Baby Comedy Hour.
Everybody loves the Crack Babies.
They sure do.
Tonight on BET, join the fun with the Crack Babies. Well, I'm glad to be home where I can finally sit in my chair, read my crack hole magazine, and smoke my crack pipe. Wait a goddamn minute. Somebody's been sitting in my chair. And some son of a bitch has been reading my crack hole magazine. And some dead mother jumper has been smoking my crack pipe. And they're still there.
Baby, wanna smoke some crack? Baby, love crack. Babies love crack so much. Crack good. Crack, 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 crack. Crack.
Those goddamn crack babies. The Crack Babies, tonight on BET.
ABC will buy the rights to that thing.
It's a cute one, actually. Andrew, you're on Ron and Fez.
Andrew.
Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez.
Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Andrew.
How about Tumor Raiders?
Oh, God, that's bad.
Tumor Raiders. All right, thanks a lot. There we go. Rich, you're on the Ron and Fez show. Hi, Rich.
Hey, how you doing, buddies?
Yeah.
I got a show called, it's hosted by Bill Cosby.
Nice.
It's called Kids Die of the Darndest Things. What do you think?
I'm not watching. I'm telling you right now, I'm not watching.
ABC seems to think there's a market for it.
They're wrong.
Kids Die of the Darndest Things. That's probably going to be followed by the ABC Crippled Kid Movie of the Week.
Mad Mike, you're on Ron and Fez.
Mad Mike.
Hey, what's up, boys?
Hey, buddy.
ABC is coming out with Whose Line Is It Anyway? They're coming out with IV lines. They're going to pass around the IV line.
Oh, so there you go.
Whose IV line is it anyway?
I bombed the best. Well, I could have been top of the pyramid.
Well, it was actually...
Could I slur my words anymore, and I haven't even been drinking.
All right, Mike.
Whose line is it anyway? Oh, I blew it.
You just go with whose IV line is it everyone? Try it over again. Just do whose IV line
is it anyway? There we go.
That Mike is great. Thanks, buddy.
That Mad Mike.
Oh, Mad Mike. We have the best callers in the business, period. They even know when they're not on, okay? They even know when they're not on.
They will critique themselves. They're that good.
They're the best.
We don't have to do a thing with these callers. They're an automatic pilot at this point. 877-692-1027.
Fez, a guy who likes Kidney Failure Funhouse. That could be fun. You know, because you're having fun. Just because your kidneys have shut down doesn't mean you don't like have a little cartoon.
Sure. They'll be watching that at the dialysis daycare center.
Talking like Mad Mike over here. I don't know what the hell happened. Here's Dave. Dave, you're on Ron and Fez.
Dave.
Hey, Ron. Hey, Fez. How about Siamese Sesame Street?
Just saw kids attached. I think Drudge is running a Siamese split twins today. Check up on them.
Oh, the conjoined twins? One of them had to go back into surgery for some bleeding. I guess first time they split anyone from the head?
Yeah.
Wow. That's a tough one.
What about Pee-wee's Iron Lunghouse? Does that work for you at all, or...
That I might tune into. A lot of these I won't. That one I might.
Because it's Pee-wee, and you like him.
Sure, I'm a fan.
Go ahead, do your impression, Fez.
It's the Iron Lunghouse!
See, that's good stuff, and you don't do it enough.
I love that story.
You could be the next Dickie Goodman.
I hope.
We're 20 minutes away.
Yeah, the clock is ticking now on the Dickie Goodman bit. I can't wait. Billy Staples, he says he's going to come up with another Dickie Goodman classic.
Even though Dickie.
Poor Dickie.
Larry, you're on Ron and Fez.
Larry.
Instead of Wonderama, how about Wonder Trauma?
It's the Wonder Trauma show.
Okay.
I like the delivery.
Sure. Because everything seems like it's a secret.
All right, Ronnie, let me ask you if you'd watch any of these shows here. When Dogs Attack Children.
Yeah.
You'd watch that one.
Yeah.
All right. Deaf kids on train tracks.
Why not?
All right.
Because they're not going to know when to move.
Or America's Funniest Morbidly Obese Children's Videos.
I think that's on anyway.
That one I would watch.
All right, Fezzy, remember the little discussion we were having together of can males have healthy children no matter what age?
Right, if they impregnate them, their wives, is there a risk that an older male could have a child with a birth defect?
Right. Rottweiler on the instant feedback says sperm is new all the time. Eggs are with women from birth.
That I did not know.
Yeah, you are born with the amount of eggs that you're ever going to be born with.
So you're never going to get more eggs. You're not going to produce more eggs.
Right. You just run the ones that you have.
All right. So they just, and that's when they drop.
They kind of drop.
Ronnie's having to tell me about the birds and the bees.
Right. They're kind of like in a little sack, and they just spit out once a month.
Okay.
Like clockwork. With the man, the risk is greater for the woman as they get older because those eggs have been in her body exposed to toxins, solar radiation, etc. like that.
Oh, so anything that the mother's done...
Over the test of time, yeah.
Right, it's sopping into those eggs. They're soaking it up.
The same thing that's, I guess, making her body, past a certain age, start to deteriorate. The same thing that's happening to those eggs.
The eggs are going to break down as
right.
well.
They're not as healthy as... The first couple eggs that just come spitting out of there, just shiny and new.
And yet the sperm cells are brand new all the time.
Every batch.
Wow, that's good to know.
Yeah.
Nice fresh batch.
I like those hideous old eggs the women are walking around in. I'll tell you, and normally I don't agree with you, Fez, but you might be right about women being filthy.
Oh, yeah. Well, first of all, they're ugly and they're stupid. And now we're finding out, not very hygienic. Bunch of old eggs hanging out there. Like keeping eggs in your refrigerator too long.
Hi, Fezzy. Rory handed me a...
spy report.
Those conjoined twins, both doing very well right now.
Oh, that's good. All right. So they were removed from each other. They were separated at the head.
Yeah.
Wow, I wonder if they had to take, was there enough brain for everybody?
Yeah, I don't think the brain was... I don't think they would separate them if they had the same brain. I think they had two separate brains.
All right, so it's just really a lot of skull tissue.
Skull, yeah.
Skull bone and head tissue that they had to cut apart.
Horde King is also written, and he backs up the tired egg theory and sperm always being fresh and new. So
he would
worry.
Know.
Yeah.
All right, so Tony Randall, Larry King, Don Imus, you got no problems. Keep having the children.
Guy is mad over the sperm thing, but I'm sorry. Our sperm is fresh and new every time.
Fresh as a daisy.
While your eggs just get hideously old.
Oh, the eggs are turning brown. You crack one of those things open, Ronnie? It smells like sulfur.
You just grossed me out, seriously.
It's true. Those are some old eggs that these women collect over the years.
Would you eat a fried human egg?
Oh, no. I don't think that way.
I've eaten them like sushi.
Really?
Don't even bother me.
Like roe. Salmon like roe.
Fish roe. All right, we got to take a break, Fez. There's no way out of that.
877-692-1027. Good work on the comedy pyramid, people.
And not only do you laugh, but you learn a little bit, don't you?
Yes, we did. We learned about conjoined twins. We learned about women's old, old, gnarled eggs and men's fresh sperm.
It's a run and fizz.
Hawk, I need something else, buddy. Thank you.
Ron and Fez, 1027 WNEW
and EW. The Obie and Anthony Show.
Full of gut busting, ab crunching, fall out of your seat, surprising.
So tomorrow at 3, 1027 WNEW.
Are you in a dead end job?
You know I am.
You're not. Other people are.
I'm going to get away from you.
You're fine. I can hear you. I'm right here doing a commercial with you.
Maybe if I had the skills.
Fairleigh Dickinson University's Computer Career Institute. That's the answer if you're looking for skills that are going to get you a great job.
If that could get me away from Fez, I'd be the happiest man in the world.
I'm right here. I can hear you say these things about me.
Now, Fairleigh Dickinson is the number one choice for computer career training. And within 7 to 28 weeks, folks, Mark my words. I'll be educated and I'll get away from Fez.
You will not. You'll always be with me.
No.
Now, other people, they can learn in 7 to 28 weeks things like PC service and support, networking, network security, Oracle Database Administration, programming, and more, all from Fairleigh Dickinson.
I'll be like this in 28 weeks. Let me get that on the computer. Thank you.
You will not. You'll be here with me.
I'll be hacking into stuff.
He's a hacker. Watch out. Get training the skills that today's employers demand most. Give them a call at Fairleigh Dickinson, 1-800-466-4360.
Hey, wait a minute. Say that number again.
I'm not giving you the number. This is just for the listeners. 1-800-466-4360.
That spells no more Fez.
It does not.
Does it?
No, it couldn't possibly. Give them a call or check them out online at fdutrain.com. Or they got some open houses going on August 13th in Paramus or August 15th in Madison where you might be able to win a full fall scholarship.
I'll show up there in a suit if it means getting away from Fez.
You do not put on a suit. You're sticking with me. I'm not going anywhere without you.
Fez, I can't go on like this. I need an adult's job. I'm living like a child.
Fairleigh Dickinson University Computer Career Institutes are located in Paramus and Madison, New Jersey.
I want out.
This segment of Ron and Fez is brought to you by Rayco 3 Motors.
Ron Fez. Ron Fez.
1027 WNEW.
Ron Bennington. Fez Watley. In The Road to Submission.
Tap out, Fez. I mean it.
Ow, ow, ow.
I'll break your ankle.
No, I won't do it. I won't do it. Get off.
Say it. Say it now. Just say it. Say it.
All right. Next time I won't forget. The cigars! Get off me!
Ow. Ron and Fez's The Road to Submission. This film is based on a true story.
We're Ron and Fez on a Tuesday. Your chance to win a C Street Cruise giveaway.
You know you need unique New York.
You gotta be able to pronounce the name of the game before you try to answer the question. And you know you need Unique New York, and it is your chance to win a cruise package from Sea Streak for two. These packages include trips to the Mets games, the Yankees games, they have a Hudson River Dayline cruise, trips to Monmouth Park Racetrack, and of course, their famous sunset cruises. For more info, or check out the schedules, go to seastreak.com, or give them a call, 1-800-BOAT-RIDE.
Now, of course, not only do you have to know the answer to the question, well, you got to be able to say the name of the game show. You know you need Unique New York.
So make sure you get past that first part before you even try to answer the question. Here's the question, Ronnie. Who became the first black player to play with the New York Yankees?
Was it Earl?
No, it was not Black Earl Douglas. He wishes.
Joey, you're on Ron and Fez. What's the name of the game show?
Oh, you need Unique New York.
Oh. Johnny, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing, buddy?
Johnny.
How you doing?
What's the name of the game show?
You know you need Unique New York.
All right. Who was the first black player on the New York Yankees?
Oh, God, you're killing me. I'm going to have to say Bernie Williams.
He's kicking down those walls, Bernie Williams.
To me, he is the first really black guy. Here's Bob, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Bob, what's the name of this game show we're playing?
You know you need Unique in New York.
Bobby!
Mandingo!
White people are so scared of black people.
Greg, you're on Ron and Fez show.
Greg!
Yo!
What's the name of the game show?
You know you need Unique New York.
All right, who's the first black player on the New York Yankees?
Jackie Robinson.
He knew it was wrong and had his Sia ready to go.
Sure, you want to just bail out of there coolly with a Sia. And Lisa, you're on Ron and Fez.
You know you need a Unique New York.
Oh, that was rough. I don't think she knew the answer, so she decided to kill herself. Steve, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Steve.
I know you need Unique New York.
It's you know you need.
Unique New York.
Not I know you need.
I know you need it.
Johnny, you're on Ron and Fez. What's the name of the game show?
You know you need unique New York.
All right.
All right. Who was the first black player on the New York Yankees?
Elston Howard.
There's the winning cowbell, Johnny.
Nice.
Hold on, Johnny.
You hold on the line, and you're going to get a C Street cruise package for two. Check them out online, cstreak.com, or give them a call if you want to check out the schedules. 1-800-BOAT-RIDE. Enjoy that, Johnny. 877-692-1027. Ronnie, there are some Bridgeport, Connecticut people that are very happy this night. In their neighborhood, they had a woman who was harassing them. They had a bad neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
Someone suffering from neighbor rage. This woman did all kinds of things. She stole flowers from their garden. She scratched their cars. Harassed children. She was putting nails under tires. Dumping leaves into other people's yards. She was actually peeking in windows at one point. She was going out at night throwing trash cans. She was actually throwing things at children, the court documents showed.
Wow.
She was constantly being hauled into court for these things she was doing in her neighborhood, terrorizing this Bridgeport community.
Nothing worse than having a bad neighbor because it affects your entire life. It's worse than having a bad brother because you can get away from your brother.
Yeah, this you can't escape from, the horrible, horrible neighbor. Well, the judge, Ronnie, in the Bridgeport Superior Court, he has put down a sentence that is going to make all her neighbors happy. He has kicked Maria Costa out of the country. You're that bad of a neighbor, you've been deported.
Was she an immigrant?
She must have been an immigrant, must have had the green card or however that works, for 20 years.
That makes sense. You can't get along with America. You can't listen to the judge. Get the F out.
So she was jailed up until last week, then escorted to John F. Kennedy International Airport and put on a plane for her native Portugal.
Oh, bad neighbors. Nothing worse.
20 years these people suffered with this woman in this neighborhood of just her terror.
I hate a bad neighbor.
Oh. I've had some awful neighbors. There's like a revolving door in that apartment next door to me.
Yeah.
I had the woman who would get scared at night during thunderstorms and would wail at the top of her lungs, moaning Myrtle. She would scream at the top of her lungs. I thought someone was killing a baby at one point.
They get nuts. I've had plenty of bad neighbors. I even had one where the little kid next door used to try to actually walk into the house. So I would have to lock the door to feel like I wasn't going to look like the crazy pedophile.
What makes someone, even a kid, think, I'm free to just walk into someone else's home?
And I'm not a door locker.
Right.
But you got to be, because you're watching TV and then suddenly there's a strange kid walking around. Oh, and was his dad a drunk?
Really?
Oh, his dad was a drunk. You'd see him sleeping on the front stoop.
That's sad.
Here's James. James, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, James, what's going on?
Hey, what's up, buddy?
Hey, buddy.
What's going on? Yeah, I was one of those terrible neighbors, actually, a few months ago, to tell you the truth, up in college at the University of Scranton.
You were the bad neighbor.
Yeah, unfortunately, we had one incident where we had a keg, and we were kind of standing on the third floor balcony of my house. Kind of tossed it off the side of it. Next thing I know, it goes through the lady's window. And this lady was not too happy, put it that way.
Now, were you in a fraternity house?
No, but I live with 12 guys, so we were kind of... I mean, she put up with a lot of crap from us. I mean, basically every day there was parties, like people throwing stuff at her house.
Why would you have 12 guys in one house?
How do we do it?
Yeah, why?
Why? I look back on my 4 years in college, and I think about it now, and I have no idea why. My grades suffered, but my social life was great, though.
What? You're with 11 other guys. What kind of social life is that? That's great if you're on a football team.
Hummers.
But to live, that's ridiculous. You slob, you animal house, Belushi bastard.
I had some guys that had an apartment below mine one time. And every night, that was when we were doing mornings. And every night, right around 10 o'clock, they would just crank the music. And my floor would shake. Things would fall off of my shelves. I'd be laying in bed, and the bed was vibrating from underneath with the repercussions.
And, you know, you don't want to be that, now Fez is the old lady.
Right.
But come on.
You want to be friends with people, but
right.
God.
And, you know, when you have that fight with the neighbor, it's never going to change. And if the cops ever show up, it's always going to be tense.
Oh, then it's
20
done.
Years later.
Yeah. Then you're the cop caller or, you know.
Then you're grouchy old men.
Yeah.
Where you're just trying to get even with each other forever.
You look at the bad neighbor never thinks whatever they're doing is that bad.
Right.
So when the cops show up, you just look insane to them.
Sure you do.
That you went that far.
Yeah, when the cops show up, there's no way to explain anything to a cop.
877-692-1027 is the toll-free phone number.
Here's Matt. Matt, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Matt. What do you got, buddy?
Hey, Ron and Fez.
Go ahead, Matt.
Big ass card holder, 12150. Thanks, guys. Yeah, one time this lady just came into my house out of nowhere. She had her little bowling ball purse with her hand, and I'm like, lady, what the F are you doing? She was crazy. I don't even think she knew where she was.
Was it a neighbor or just a nutty lady?
No, it was just some lady. I thought she was crazy, I think.
All right, thanks. Sit.
Really old lady. Sit.
Thanks for the call, Matt.
Hey, Lauren, you're on Ron and Fez.
Lauren.
Hey, how are you guys?
Yeah.
I am one of those neighbors that, I'm a bad neighbor, I guess, because it's like, we're all adults, so it's like, if you like to have sex, it's like, I like loud sex. And I think that's, and I'm like, I think about it, but then I'm like, I don't care. I'm like, so I don't, you know what I mean?
So you have loud sex.
Yeah.
How loud?
Loud enough. I mean, the walls are thin. I mean, I can hear them if they're doing it, so I'm sure they hear me because I'm louder than they are. They sound like they're watching it.
You're in an apartment?
Yeah.
And you could care less what the neighbors think, that you're, you know,
annoying
them,
I mean,
invading their privacy, really.
Well, I don't do it real late at night. I don't do it too early in the morning, so I'm like, why should it bother them?
But have they complained to you about it?
No.
You want them to.
So you're just making all this up. You called to brag.
No, I'm not.
That you're Miss Sex Lady.
Here's Rob. Rob, you're on Run
of Fame. That was pathetic. Hey, Rob, go ahead.
Hey, how you guys doing?
All right, by the way, we're 6.5 minutes late with Billy's Dickie Goodman bit. He should be forced to play Make Me Laugh.
That's fair.
What can we do for you, Rob?
Hey, Rob.
Yeah, I had these neighbors. We were on the second floor of a two-family house. And they used to leave all their windows open at night and get busy, and you could see the whole thing. And it was, sometimes it was interesting to watch, but sometimes it was a little uncomfortable.
So would you say bad neighbors or good neighbors there?
I'd say bad neighbors.
Were they at least attractive people?
Not particularly, no.
You're dealing with ugly naked guy or whatever.
Right. So. Only it's ugly, naked, sex-having couple.
And then seeing them the next day was always a little awkward, you know?
Thanks. All right, the hawk keeps saying stuff to me. He wants to come over.
All right, he probably has a hawk back about bad neighbors.
I had this one neighbor. She was blind as a bat, and she was really paranoid. And every couple hours, she would come over and ring your bell, and she's like, I hear movement in my apartment, but I can't see anything. Can you come over and check? So you'd go over there and check.
I hear movement.
You'd go over, and she did this to everyone in the building, not just me. And there'd be roaches everywhere. She heard the roaches walking around.
Oh, gross!
And you'd explain that to her, and she wouldn't believe you. She'd think, you know, someone was in her apartment walking around and moving things and, like, just tiptoeing around.
It was the roaches stealing her furniture. Maybe you were living next door to Daredevil. Ever think of that?
Oh, it was horrible.
I hear movement.
So gross.
There were thousands of them.
Oh, it's Joe's apartment.
I had a neighbor used to whiz right in my yard sometimes.
Really?
Say, Travis, get back to your house.
Oh, God. And what a pig.
Then I also say, oh, by the way, we found out your brother's not one of the Florida Knolls. He goes to a junior college.
Liar and a bad neighbor.
Right.
It's the worst combo.
Here's, Matt, you're on Matt Fez.
Hey, Matt.
Hey, how's it going?
Yeah, buddy.
Yeah, I was the worst neighbor ever, man.
Why?
I used to pump Van Halen Jump on 11 all the time.
Jump.
And one incident in particular, where my upstairs neighbor, he was from Nebraska, and apparently he saw me out on the street naked.
Yeah.
And,
Let me get back to this. You were just playing the single, Jump?
Oh, all the time, man.
But why just that?
I would sample 1984, but for the most part, it was Jump.
Just over and over again.
Over and over again.
Why
man.
Would you do this?
It's the greatest rock and roll song ever written.
Yeah, sure, if you're a Cubs fan. But what about the rest of us? What an idiot.
What a bad neighbor.
Here's, Oh, I lost him. Here's Steve. Steve, you're on Ron and Fez.
Steve, what's going on?
Hey, buddy.
Buddy.
Hey, I had a neighbor would get medieval on our asses, and she started throwing oil down in the projects.
Hot oil?
Hot oil from a window.
Why?
I don't know. We were playing tennis against the concrete wall, and she would just spray our asses.
All right, no.
She'd dump a hot pot of Crisco on them, Ronnie.
Yeah, she'd wait out, heating it up, wait
when,
to drop it
when
on.
I was a kid, I could not throw a ball against a wall. If I had a tennis ball, it had to be constantly pounding off a wall. And my old man would come flying out of the house freaking out.
There'd be marks all over his paint. From that dirty ball hitting his house.
Russ, you're on Ron and Fez.
Russ.
Yeah.
Buddy.
How are you?
Go ahead, Russ.
I got my brother's house, the neighbor next door one night. He looked out his window and he saw the guy burying something out there. He looked out there the next day and he saw this little raccoon claw sticking out of the ground.
Ew. So what was it?
The guy buried a dead raccoon in his yard.
Why?
I don't know. Guy.
Just because he didn't want it in his own yard?
I guess so. I asked my brother what he did. He said nothing. I said I would have threw it back in his driveway or something. I don't know what the hell the guy's problem was.
Thanks.
Jeez. Yeah. I can't believe the people that just walk the dog and let it go in someone else's yard.
Fez, a little
spy report
on the news story that you told us. Chris from Bridgeport said that lady was called the North End Terrorist.
Wow.
And she's been called that for years by everybody. Chris, if you could call us, I'd love to hear some of these true stories.
Sure.
They sent her back to Portugal. A lot of Portuguese in the Bridgeport area.
Putting her on a plane. That'll take care of the bad neighbor problem.
She had citizenship in both countries.
Hello?
And literally booted from the country. Not even like the neighborhood. Steven, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Steven.
I always wanted to do this. Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez.
Hi, Steven.
Hi. Listen, I was the worst neighbor, you know. Back in my teenage years, you know, mid to late, you know, I was like considered the perv of not only my building, you know, where I live, but the whole block. Everybody.
What would you
at
do?
Me. Yeah, I was a peeping Tom. I used to go around, look at all the girls in the building, you know, in the fire escapes, in the bathroom.
What right. A weirdo.
Thanks.
All right.
I have no sympathy for the people who are calling in saying they're the bad neighbors. You're awful people.
Tim, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Tim, what's going on?
Hey.
Go ahead, Tim.
Hey, Ron. Hey, Fez.
Hey, buddy, go ahead.
Yeah, my neighbor hit me in the face with a snow shovel when I was 9 years old because I was sitting in her car. I was sitting on her car.
She hit you right in the face?
With a snow shovel, yeah.
What did you end up doing?
I ended up going home and telling my mom, and before I got home, she was on the phone with my mom telling her how sorry she was and how she overreacted.
I'm sorry I hit your son in the face with a snow shovel.
That's like something out of Bugs Bunny.
Thanks, guys. See ya.
Thanks for the call, Tim.
Here is, Johnny, Hard Rock Johnny.
Beautiful. Johnny!
Hello, boys.
How you doing? We're looking forward to Friday night, the 23rd, the Ron and Festival of Rockin' Ribs at the Hard Rock Cafe.
We're looking forward to it, too, although this Pharrell thing is kind of scaring me.
How can I mean when you shake it up?
I was walking across the street today, and he came running across Broadway to grab me and give me a big hug and tell me how he was going to drink 50 beers for charity.
All right, so the idea...
For charity now.
Charity? Where did that come from?
I don't know. He's going to try to raise money for charity by drinking beer.
So the beer drinking idea is still in his head. He hasn't forgotten that in a 24-hour period.
No, he's still manic.
Unbelievable.
Pharrell wants to sit on stage and down 50 beers while the Rockin' Ribs Festival's going on.
For charity.
Nice. What can we do for you tonight, Johnny?
I want to actually tell you about my neighbor when I was in growing up. This lady, we would play, you know, stickball in the street, and if you hit a ball into her driveway, into her yard, she'd keep them. She'd never give them back to us.
Oh, yeah.
She's the nastiest, meanest old lady in the world. And then she had this driveway that was made out of, you know, it was all gravel. She'd be out there every day raking the gravel just so she'd be out there in case one of the balls happened to stray up there. She'd keep it. I don't know what she did with all those balls, but she had a collection of them.
You know, now...
The old lady.
Yeah, it's just an awful thing to take a kid's toy.
Yeah.
A lot of people, they'd have that basketball or something for 2 seconds, that brand-new football, and boom, it's in that yard and it's gone.
See you, Johnny.
See you, boys.
Thanks, Johnny. We'll see you on the 23rd of this month.
Here's Tom. Tom, you're on Ron Fez.
Tom, what can we do for you?
Yeah, I got a bad neighbor. Yeah, the woman keeps dumping her hot dog water from her hot dog cart in my backyard.
Do you live near the Staples?
Yeah, the drunken kid, yeah, the 40-year-old kid now moves back in. He's blasting air sick all day. I can't take it.
Oh. See you. Thank you. You do not live next door to the Staples. Billy, of course, is still working on his Dickie Goodman bit. We'll have one of those musical interviews, hopefully by the end of the night. He's 15 minutes late with it.
What's the story on that, Rory?
What's going on in the production room with Captain No Laughs?
He just finished cutting everything and he's just tightening it up, making it fit all nicely.
Oh, God.
He had to do that with his pants.
Why do you always have to be mean to him?
He's 15 minutes late with this bit. And that was to get him out of play and make me laugh.
I know, he should still have to play Make Me Laugh. Although I don't know if I can take it anymore. It's so painful.
It's Billy taking a caller to task, seeing if he can make them laugh in 60 seconds.
Hey, Fez, let's try and guess the person's name on line 10.
Wow, I'll go ahead and say Roach.
Hey, buddy, shake it up.
Is it Roach?
Hey, buddy, shake it up.
Is that your name?
Yes, that's, well, it's a nickname.
It's spelled phenomenally.
How you doing, buddies?
What can we do for you?
Yeah, all right. I had this a-hole of a neighbor, right? Had this vicious dog. He used to run around their backyard, go nuts. He used to kill animals left and right. My neighbor used to throw the animals over the fence into my yard. I walk out in a hot summer day. I got dead carcasses laying around my backyard, smelly animals laying at my feet.
And why did he have so many dead animals?
Because this neighbor of mine had this dog that used to run around their yard, right? Used to kill all sorts, like little squirrels.
Like rats and squirrels and stuff, okay.
Yeah. It was, right, thanks, it was pretty bad.
Right.
And your yard was the dumping ground, Roach.
Here's Gina, you're on Ron and Fez.
Gina, what can we do for you?
Hi. Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez. How you doing?
Good,
okay.
Sweetheart.
We had a neighbor we used to call Mr. Mean Guy, and if our balls went over his fence, he used to chop them up with an axe and throw them back over, like our baseballs and stuff.
He used to chop your balls with an axe?
Yes, not my balls personally, but
oh,
my brother's.
No. That's when you started going by the name Gina. It was Gino.
And also, if we were riding our bikes past his house, we had to go on in the street at that point, but he would spray us with the hose.
That sounds good, though.
Yeah.
All right, that's it.
That sounds like it would feel good. 877-692-1027. Talking about the Bridgeport, Connecticut woman. She was known as the North End Terrorist. She was such a bad neighbor, she got deported by a judge back to Portugal.
Good. That should just be the start of it all. Mark, you're on Ron and Fez.
Clean up Bridgeport. Hey, Mark.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Hey.
Got a hold of 1422. Yeah, Ronnie, I had a little kid that used to live next door to me walk in my house.
Was it Travis?
Yeah. That was his name, I swear to God.
No.
Did he wet on your yard?
No, he'd open his sliding glass door, walk in, close behind
him. Wait. I'm the one who says things.
All right, he used to walk in. What would he do?
Well, we tell him that our kids weren't home, and he'd tell us he was going upstairs to play Nintendo.
Oh, God. Jeez.
What a
nightmare. That's the only thing you can do is throw him out.
His name was Travis. He was about 6 years old.
That is the weirdest thing ever. That's the weirdest thing ever. Hey, we got to take a break. Is Dickie Staples almost done?
It'll be done when we come back from break, definitely.
Is that a threat?
Yeah, unfortunately it is.
All right.
Stay tuned
for Dickie Staples.
Coming up, his latest interview. 877-692-1027.
Ron and Fez.
Ron and Fez. 1027 WNEW.
Did you see the day I had today? First, Olive and I are going to get business cards. Then I got an important luncheon at noon. Then I'm going to the CBS NFL Today blowout barbecue on 57. Ooh la la, baby. So gaudy.
Sports in the morning with Pharrell. Tomorrow morning live at 5:45. 1027 WNEW.
Our friends, there's two ways to book a hotel online. You can go through dozens of websites.
Now, friends, let me tell you something. When you travel, across this country, you don't want to pay top prices, friends. You got to listen to your good friends, Ron Fez.
Or you can go to Hotwire.
Friends, we're doing radio in the 1930s, friends. Now, what I want you to do is scoot over to that computer, that home computer of yours, and take that Hotwire challenge, friends.
They are going to find you the lowest hotel prices guaranteed. If you find a room in the same hotel on the same dates for a lower price, Hotwire is going to pay you double the difference.
That's double the difference, and that's guaranteed. From your Uncle Ronnie and your Aunt Fezzy here, we're going to be with you all the time.
Check out some of the recent hot rates booked on Hotwire. 3.5-star hotel in downtown Chicago, just $65 a night.
That's right, friends. $65 a night. You can be staying looking over the Great Lakes, friends.
Or a 4-star hotel in Midtown Manhattan, only $124 a night.
And, friends, you know that's good prices for downtown Manhattan.
Now, rates change all the time, so take the Hotwire Travel Challenge for yourself and compare Hotwire to the other travel sites out there. Then log back on to Hotwire for a better hotel deal, guaranteed. Thank you.
1027 WNEW, New York. Ron and Fez.
Frequency.
1027 WNEW. Ron Bennington. Fez Watley. In The Road to Magician.
Hey, Ron, watch me make a rabbit disappear.
Why, Fez, you run out of gerbils?
Hey!
Ron and Fez's The Road to Magician. This film is actually a radio parody spot.
We're Ron and Fez. Ron Bennington, Fez Watley with you.
All right, Billy's ready to play another round of Make Me Laugh.
Nice! Where you wait on the line, if Billy can make you laugh, well, you lose.
Because, Billy, you're supposed to do this by 9:30. You're supposed to have your gig.
Oh, yeah, well, Ronnie, it was ready to go. I can't speed up the production, people.
All right, yeah, good point.
I was on the phone since quarter after, all set and ready to go.
So blame the guys that helped you. Very nice.
Well, it's a teamwork. You know, it's a team. You know, a lot of work involved in something like this. You know, pulling songs, writing the jokes. You know, it doesn't happen magically. It's a lot of work.
All right, this is your latest Dickie Goodman bit. Of course, anyone who knows the bit knows it's some famous person getting interviewed, but the responses aren't the person. They're just clips from songs.
And, Billy, you said you grew up on Dickie Goodman and you thought he was just amazing, right?
Oh, he was my hero when I was a kid with the Jaws and the Star Wars. It was my first... I wanted to be like him when I used to hear the novelty songs on the radio.
I wish you were like him, too. Dead. Now, are you going to be doing this stuff when you're with Norton?
Oh, no. This is something just for you guys.
Why don't you go up there with a soundboard and play this whole thing out together?
No, this is something that's just for the Ron and Fez show and the Ron and Fez listeners.
Now, the one you did before, you just used Connie Chung as the interviewer. Who's doing it on this one?
That would be me.
All right, so did you want to play Make Me Laugh tonight?
No, not tonight. That's saving that for tomorrow night.
All right, tomorrow night definitely, all right?
All right, tomorrow night you play Make Me Laugh with Billy Staples for a chance to win tickets to Jim Norton's Jello Discipline Tour, the Count Basie Theater in Red Bank, New Jersey, where Billy Staples will be opening.
Yeah.
All right. Now, what is this Dickie Goodman bit about? Who are you interviewing here, Dickie?
The man of the hour, Mr. Osama bin Laden.
He's the man of the hour.
Well, he's the most wanted man right now, so who better to talk to than him? I'm sitting here and talking with the most wanted man, Osama bin Laden, hiding in his cave. Now, tell me, I know that you are a wanted man and are hiding. May I still call you Osama? I must say, Al, you're looking a little thin and pale. Have you not eaten lately? How are you feeling? Can I get you something to eat? What was it that your aides told you when the U.S. came after you? Is there any place you think you can really hide from the U.S.? What will you say when they finally capture you?
They're coming to take me away, haha.
Why are you hiding?
I'm afraid of America.
Osama, why do you hate Americans so much?
America.
If you could send a message to your family right now, what would it be? What alternative plans do you have to avoid capture? And finally, Mr. Bin Laden, when you finally are captured, what do you think President Bush will say?
All right.
Woo!
Dickie Staples interviewing Osama bin Laden.
I never just remembered it falling off like that at the end.
I always thought there was a goodbye or a thank you, something to end the interview.
Some kind of a wrap-up.
Well, there was a time constraint. There would have been a complete wrap-up, but we just wanted to make sure we got it on the air in time.
All right. Some of the things I noticed, you used Bruce Springsteen as the voice of Osama bin Laden at one point. For some reason, a Pat Benatar song always seems to make the lineup.
Well, she's very, she has a lot of good hooks with her music. They fit in well to the Dickie Goodman style.
All right. Those are just a couple of things I noticed.
I always remember that Dickie would use the top songs of the day, not span 40 different years.
Well, that's where we differ, you see. I span a whole many generations. I got Jimmy Eat World in there, you know, for the kids of today, and I went back a little while, you know, a little bit of everything for everybody.
And you actually used, what was it, Napoleon the 16th or whatever?
Yeah, they're coming to take me away.
You used a novelty song in a novelty song.
Well, he was more of a wacko. He had escaped from a mental hospital, so I wouldn't call it a novelty. He was just a little wacky.
That was a novelty song. Rich, you're on Ron Fez.
Hi,
Rich.
Ron, hi, Fez.
Hi, Rich.
I remember when I was younger and I was listening to that for the first time, I thought it was bad then.
Right, so did I. When I was a kid, I thought these are awful.
But this is so much better now.
It's still horrible.
All right, see.
Thanks.
Thanks for the call, Rich.
Bob, you're on Ron and Fez.
Bob, what can we do for you tonight?
Hi, Ron. Hi, Fez.
Hey.
Hey, Bob.
If this was 1981, that would still be bad.
Yeah.
It's 20 years behind the music. You're putting one song that's been out for the past 2 years doesn't cut it. The last time Billy did anything funny in public was when he fell down the stairs of the Belmore Railroad.
Oh, that was great days. Those were great times.
Up the stairs.
Billy, you need a show on VH1, Behind in the Music. Billy fell up the stairs again. And he always hits something glass.
Ah! I'm suing you. Oh, I'm hurt. Oh, my neck. My back. My neck and my back. Oh, I want $150,000.
All right, Ian, you're on Iron Fuzz.
Ian, what can we do for you tonight?
Hey, what's up, guys?
Go ahead, buddy.
Yeah, you got to give Billy some credit. That was some pretty funny stuff.
What did you like?
I don't know. He had a good selection of songs, you know. If he had enough time, he would really come across with something really funny.
Did you like him as the announcer?
I don't know about that as the announcer, but for like that, he's the guy you need.
All right, thanks a lot. All right.
Thanks, Aaron.
Yes. Turning around.
Yes, for bad bits, he is definitely the guy we need.
Come on, that was put together in a short span of time and damn funny also. Come on, it's like you guys were holding back the smiles. It was good. I guarantee you, people are going to play it again right now out in their cars.
I will tell you this. I am always holding back my smile anytime you're talking.
I was holding back a crap.
All right, let's play it one more time. Please, the people that love it.
All right, Dickie Staples.
Dickie Staples. It's Dickie Goodman meets Billy Staples.
Interviewing Osama bin Laden.
I'm sitting here and talking with the most wanted man, Osama bin Laden, hiding in his cave. Now tell me, I know that you are a wanted man and are hiding. May I still call you Osama?
Oh, yeah.
I must say, Al, you're looking a little thin and pale. Have you not eaten lately? How are you feeling? Can I get you something to eat? What was it that your aides told you when the U.S. came after you? Is there any place you think you can really hide from the U.S.? What will you say when they finally capture you?
They're coming to take me away, haha.
Why are you hiding?
I'm afraid of America.
Osama, why do you hate Americans so much?
America, home of the free.
If you could send a message to your family right now, what would it be? What alternative plans do you have to avoid capture?
I think I'm gonna kill myself.
And finally, Mr. bin Laden, when you finally are captured, what do you think President Bush will say?
Put a gun against his head. Pulled my trigger, now he's dead.
Thank you, Dickie Staples.
Oh, that's so awful.
It gets better every time I hear it.
Here's Tom. Tom, you're on Ron and Fez.
Tom. Hey, guys. How you doing? Tom Johnson here, program director for Z100.
Hey, Tom.
I want Billy to play that tomorrow morning on the Wacky Z Morning Zoo. This guy's got talent. He's going places.
Yeah, we wish he would go. All right. Billy, why don't you head on over to the zoo show?
All right.
No, this is a perfect fit for you guys.
No, it's not.
You know, and some of those things are just so cliche. What do you want me to call you? Call me Al. I mean, it's just so obvious. I want candy. Of course you're going to use those stupid songs.
But it's the beginning of the interview. You got to set the premise. You know, when you say, what would you like me to call you? It's how most interviews begin.
No, never. You ever watch Letterman and go, what should I call you?
Well, that's not a news program. This is a news interview.
Name one news. Name what Dan Rather says to a world leader, what should I call you?
Should I call you Mr. Clinton?
Never. he would never say that.
Maybe the joke would have been, oh, God, I can't believe I'm helping him. You know, do you want to be called Al-Qaeda or something shorter? You know, what's short for Al-Qaeda? You can call me Al.
That's funny. Thanks. Hey, Joe, you're on Running Fez.
Hey, Joe.
Hey, I don't Billy, you suck. Die, you pig. Die.
You liked it.
No, you know we didn't. Here's Jeb. Jeb, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Jeb.
Hey, guys, is this the Jacksonville Morning Zoo show? I thought that was just terrific.
It's the ape.
we're
on the ape.
And we're getting a call from Jeb Bush.
It's Lex and Terry.
You know, it's all that good music from the discount rack at Kmart. You can't beat it.
Thank you very much.
Maybe one day, Billy, you'll be in the discount rack.
Bob, you're on Ron and Fez.
Bob, what can we do for you?
Yeah, hey, Ron and Fez. I think Billy is on the manic, delusional upswing on his mood swing again.
Yeah, it does seem that way.
This is just really awful.
Right.
And he's
manic Tuesday.
He's convinced that he's great.
But don't you understand?
And then five days from now, we'll think he has anthrax.
They just don't appreciate it.
No, that's the truth about your comedy. No one appreciates it.
It's there.
Please don't do this gig with Norton.
Oh, it's a definite.
Please.
Ronnie, I'm going to kill you. You're going to be so proud of me. You're going to walk around with your arm around me in the studio all week.
I hope the audience kills.
It's
you.
Not just going to be me. Why don't you listen to your coworkers? Let's go to Hawk. Hawk, how do you think he's going to do opening for Norton?
It's going to be horrible.
Wow. And that's your friend, Hawk.
Thank you, Hawk.
That's the man who invented the computerized traffic
system that we're hoping to instill in this city.
It could work.
All right, grab Rory Hampton's and see if Wonder Boy can come in for 2 seconds.
What do you think? Should he do this gig?
No, definitely not.
Wow, that's too Billy.
Well, of course they're going to. You know, they worry about this.
Even
show.
Your best friend Ass Man would ask you not to do this.
No, Ass Man.
Here comes Wonder Boy.
Wonder Boy, should Billy Staples do this show Saturday night, Count Basie Theater, Red Bank, New Jersey, with Jim Norton?
I don't think it's a good idea, no. I would say it's not going to go well for Billy. So I would advise against it. If I could be Billy's manager for a minute, I would say, Billy, this is not your spot, buddy.
We're going to yank you. We're going to pull you out of this, Billy. The manager walks out to the mound. Not tonight. Tonight, give me the ball. Tonight's not your night, kid. That would be the only thing that I would laugh at if Norton actually has to walk out and take the mic off you. Why don't you take a shower, big man? We appreciate the try.
Oh, that would be so awful.
We're going to let Norton mop this up.
If you just get escorted from the stage with Norton's arm around you.
Wonder Boy, where's your little bit that you did this week for Hawk?
Actually, it's over there. I can get it.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hang on.
Go ahead and grab it. Hawk, of course. He's an idea man. Let's face the facts.
Yeah.
And he wanted to revamp the traffic system.
Which he believes, like any moron would, a computer will help. Like a computer has helped anything. Where is the Hawk? Has he leave during the show now?
All right, Wonder Boy, find your bit and go back out and get Hawk.
Hawk, where do you go?
Are they the same person? That they can't be in the room?
I'm
Hawk.
Back now.
All right, thank you.
Explain your idiotic idea, Hawk.
To save traffic problems.
Well, here's the thing. The reason why traffic happens is because it bottlenecks, and everyone tries to go in a different the same direction, and if everyone could have, like, an overview, it would work. So if a computer would take over, several huge supercomputers would take over and be able to direct traffic.
Name one supercomputer that you know of.
Big Blue.
The just plain supercomputer.
All right, so we put Big Blue on this.
Couple of them.
Big and Blue is what they could call Billy Saturday night after that show.
It could control the traffic lights and the one-way signs would be go two ways and everything.
What? On what street?
Every street. Every street would be capable of changing
signs.
Yep.
God. All right.
All right, so Wonder Boy, what was this, a song? What is it, Wonder Boy?
Yeah, it's a recap of Hawk's ideas to a popular song.
All right.
Today is popular music.
I have the solution to the traffic problem in major cities.
Everyone, please, gather around your radios. Here we go.
Around any major city, there'd be a network of sensors that can detect where all the cars are pooling and it's getting a traffic buildup, and it would change all the signs on the street to take the traffic away.
Ow.
Here in my car, I feel safest of all. I can lock all my doors. It's the only way to live.
We'll build more bridges and tunnels.
If you have more tunnels and bridges, who the hell cares?
Take the freedom away from the people. And
take the freedom away from the people.
It's like when you have too much saturated fat and you have a heart attack. A heart attack is like rush hour.
What?
If you could eliminate the blockage, everything will flow better and there'll be no blockage.
Yeah, but Hawk, what you have to do is stop the saturated fats, not suddenly have them running into your kidneys.
People would keep an open mind about this. It could work. We just need cooperation.
Hawk's theory doesn't work.
Of course it doesn't work. It came from Hawk.
Doesn't work the way the world is now.
You just broke your rule, kid. You should never talk for more than 30 seconds.
Well, you did pick a popular song. I'll give you that much, Wonder Boy.
Today's popular song by Wonder Boy. Wonder Boy, you're having me mess Dickie Staples. Hawk, your deal doesn't work for this. And I explained it to you. Fez explained it to you. And even the baby Nazi Rory explained it to you. The reason why we have traffic jam-ups here, we have 60 million cars in about a 40-mile radius. No matter what happens, we have to have less cars in this area, not more roads.
See, even if you still direct the cars somewhere else, it's still too small of an area to put them anywhere else. Unless you're running them actually into the rivers.
I think if we let the computers handle the major problems, it would work.
If you want to do something like Minority Report, where the cars actually drive up the sides of the buildings.
I want to see that now. I haven't seen it yet. Are we going to take a break? Now, Hawk? Got a little time? Because I know you're a little behind.
Take a break or don't take a break? Take a break. All right.
We'll be right back. Ron and Fez.
Ron and Fez.
You scaring me. Stop it.
1027 WNEW. Ron Bennington. Fez Wadley. In The Road to Circumcision.
Fez, put down that baby.
Tell the rabbi, never mind, Ron. I'll handle this one myself.
Fez, spit that out. You spit that out. That's the babies. That's the babies. He needs that. Fez, spit that out.
Ron and Fez's The Road to Circumcision. No children admitted without parent, guardian, or police protection.
We're back. We're Ron and Fez. Ronnie, we have a spy report coming in. The Harlem All-Stars, Ronnie, in the Mid-Atlantic Tournament of the Little League World Series, trying to get to the Little League World Series. The Harlem All-Stars lose tonight, Ronnie, to the New Jersey team.
You stink. All right, so that's over now?
Nope, still not out of the Mid-Atlantic Tournament yet. The top four teams will face each other after each team's played everybody. So they play again on Thursday against Washington. And then they have a game on Friday. Is it Friday?
Yes, it is Friday.
Friday against Pennsylvania.
They'll get killed. They'll get killed.
So they got two more games before they see who advances to the Final Four of the Mid-Atlantic Tournament to see who goes on to the Little League World Series competition.
You stink.
Some other things going on, Ronnie. You know the miners that were saved a couple weekends ago?
Sure.
All right. There was supposed to be a 10th miner trapped in that mine.
What happened?
Ozzy Osbourne saved his life. This is a 22-year-old miner. He says he should have been trapped with the other nine. That was his crew that he works with every day. But he had tickets to Ozfest. So he took the day off, missed getting trapped in the mine.
Well, that costs you $150,000.
From Disney, from Walt Disney World. The odd thing about the story is, he had the tickets. His girlfriend got him. Big Ozfest fan. Big Ozzy fan. She wanted to go. Got the tickets because the show was on his day off.
Mm-hmm.
He wouldn't be working at the mine. Sharon Osbourne gets the ass cancer. Ozzy drops off the tour. The show they went to in Pennsylvania, it's postponed to the day that the guys got trapped in the mine when he should have been working. He called in, took the day off, went to Ozfest, comes out of the concert, and has all these messages on his cell phone. Are you okay? Where are you? Are you trapped?
And now you know the rest of the story.
So Ozzy saves a life. Not that he would have been killed in that mine, but he thinks with the job he had to do, he might have been killed.
That guy must feel like an idiot.
He said he's really a miner's apprentice, and he would have been traveling up and down the mine shaft, you know, as the runner, going to get things and stuff. He thinks if he had been in that position, he might have been killed.
So we would have went 9 for 10.
Right. Which is still good, but you hate to lose anybody. Also, Ronnie, the Rosie O'Donnell show. Remember her band leader, John McDee, and the McDLTs, John McDaniel.
He's fantastic.
He's good. He's Mr. Broadway. He has a stalker now.
Guy?
No. Oddly enough, it's a homeless British woman who's loose in New York. She didn't show up for a court date where she was being brought up on stalker charges or stalker Channing. And she is now loose, and he is worried about it.
Sure. He doesn't want to get girl kissed.
She actually refers to John McDee as her fiancé. That is just pathetic to make up a fiancé. Woman is sick.
Listen to him talk, honey. He wants junk. Nothing you have interests him.
She was telling people that they're engaged, and that's how she was. That's how she gained entrance into his apartment building one night, where she showed up with a pair of scissors. He called the cops on her there.
I'm guaranteeing you, if they would quick check and tap his phone, no one's on the other end. He's making this up to look straight.
He said she actually rang the buzzer and said, I'm looking for John McDee. Calling him by his nickname.
I'm telling you, that's him in the other room with the wig on.
Hello! Playing the homeless British stalker woman. She showed up at his house with some scissors. She was calling him in his dressing room at the Rosie O'Donnell show. And she was leaving messages, things like, if you wanted to make me angry, you certainly have done so. So that scares that little frail man.
If she wants to, you know, chase somebody from that show, it's Rosie would like you.
She also left a message after the cops had already been involved saying, hi, I'm just checking in. It's been crazy lately. Bye, talk to you later.
I like that whole Rupert Pumpkin. Yeah, where's everybody else for the party?
Wow, it's been really nuts lately. You know, the cops chasing me and all, you know, away from your apartment. Whew, had some things to deal with. I've been sharpening my scissors. Really haven't had much time to talk.
Now, did John come up with this after he saw the trailer for the movie Swim Fan? Is that when he decided that he had a stalker?
She's a piano fan. Sing us a song, you're the piano fan. And as the nuts continue, Ronnie, Drew Barrymore in the news. She's lashing out at Hollywood stars that are adopting children.
Yes, that's awful.
Apparently, Drew Barrymore is against it. She seems to think, now has no evidence whatsoever, but seems to think that these Hollywood stars are adopting children for the wrong reason. She's pointing out Michelle Pfeiffer, Nicole Kidman, Diane Keaton, and Calista Flockhart, also Angelina Jolie, who recently adopted a Cambodian baby. She thinks that these people are just avoiding having natural childbirth, having their own children, so it doesn't wreck their Hollywood bodies, their fabulous, gorgeous forms.
Do you know anything that's happening with these women? Maybe they can't. Maybe there's problems. You don't know this.
She actually brought up that they're avoiding natural childbirth because of the unpleasant physical consequences on their bodies. Drew says here, do you think they do it because of their bodies? That's so effed up. I would never adopt just because I was vain.
Let that Cambodian die in his own home country, and you spit out another white baby.
The amazing thing about Drew Barrymore is she's a nut, and she'll talk, and people will listen to her.
And when Drew gets pregnant, no one notices. She's had three kids, and no one's ever brought it up to her.
She actually talks, and because she's a movie star, people will run with a microphone to listen to the next round of craziness.
How can you not? You know, why didn't she have a baby with that Canadian idiot?
Oh, Tom Green. Maybe the one nad. What's the problem?
The one nad.
Maybe the one nad Canadian wonder had a problem there.
No, I was talking, when I said, why didn't she have a baby with that Canadian idiot, I meant Geddy Lee.
Oh,
just any Canadian idiot. Doesn't matter which one.
877-692-1027 is the toll-free phone number.
Here's JJ. JJ, you're on Ron and Fez.
JJ, what can we do for you?
Ron Fez, BS cardholder, 4932.
All right, buddy.
Hoo-ah! Ooh, what's going on, guys? Disappointing news, actually. I was just listening to Wonder Boy and Hawk, and I just got to say, your show is like a whole downward spiral. I mean, even Billy Staples, as bad as he is, was way better than them twos. So.
Them twos?
Yeah, well, them two, you know. I was just really upset hearing that. I mean, these guys, they're amateurs. My little sister, who's 3 years old, could put together a better bit than those two could.
All right, have her do it. Have her do it.
Have her put together a bit and fix traffic in New York.
Hawk is trying in his own stupid, retarded way. He's trying.
Hawk, if you want to make up for it, you can tell us the price tag on that Poconos getaway home of yours.
It's just people don't want to accept the traffic idea because it's something new. Whenever there's something new, people don't get it right away. They have to be exposed to it for a while.
You're giving us nothing. Your answer to every question is...
Supercomputers.
It doesn't even make sense.
Supercomputers.
It doesn't make sense when you initially think about it. But if you think about it for a while and enough people get involved, it's going to work. It's just, you know, it's just not me and all the computers doing it. You got to have computers...
Thank God!
You got to have the computer people. You got to have engineers.
Computer people. And engineers.
Construction.
Yes, we need engineers with more trains.
So the people will get out of their cars and ride more mass transit, more efficient mass transit into this city. And we can close the streets to cars.
The only person that agrees with him this is 2001 Hal.
Hawk, I know you've been disappointed with me lately.
If you think about it, if you don't
ridicule it. I am, I'm thinking constantly, no ridicule.
If you think about it seriously, it could work. It's going to take a lot of people and a lot of computer power.
It would have to take every person, I guess, to do this stupidness.
Think of all the jobs that would be created.
I don't want to get back into this, but is it going to tell one car to go one way and another car to go another way? Or is it just going to move all the traffic into another jam somewhere?
No, you were right the first time. You're getting it, Fez. See? Now that you've thought about it, you're
starting... Honey, I'm calling. The computer won't let me take our road home.
What's going to make the car follow the computer's instructions?
It's going to be like those little race cars with the on the electric tracks.
The Matchbox?
Not the Matchbox. When you have the little controllers that you could control the amount of electricity goes and they go faster or slower, that's how it would work.
Here's Leo. Leo, you're on Ron and Fez.
Ron, you said Geddy Lee's a dumb Canadian. He rules. I want you to take that back.
I won't take it back.
Take it back.
I won't take it back.
Come on, he's the greatest. Take it back.
He's not going to take it back.
I always thought Geddy Lee was retarded since that War Between the Trees.
Oh, God.
Oh, that's a great song. Come on.
What is the name of that song?
The Trees.
It's just called The Trees.
All right,
do we have that anywhere?
All right, grab The Trees.
All right, this is Geddy Lee. Are you from Canada, Leo?
No, I just love Rush.
Why?
Heard him on Eddie Trunk, and
it's not like he broke them. They've been away for been around.
I wish he'd break their CDs.
Listen to this and tell me this is not a madman who wrote these lyrics.
Okay.
All right, first of all, it's medieval times, Fez. Hold on to Leo.
All right. As we take a trip to the Renaissance Festival here.
There is unrest in the forest. There is trouble with the trees. For the maples want more sunlight, and the oaks ignore their pleas.
All right, let's just go with that. The maples want more sunlight, and the oaks ignore their please.
There's unrest in the forest, Ronnie.
Leo, you're comfortable with this?
Well, yeah. Well, you see, the problem with the Maples, and they quite believe they're right.
All right, hold on.
More?
Yeah.
The birds and the animals.
So embarrassed. All right, now, don't you think this man should have been stopped at the border? Him and his little band turned back. Just turned back for being so damn silly.
It's a Dr. Seuss book. It's the Lorax.
All right, let's get back into it. Let's stop there. Fez, the maples scream, oppression! And the oaks just shake their heads. What heads? You must be eating acid like they're Tic Tacs.
The oaks, Ronnie, they can't understand why the maples aren't happy there in the shade. In their shade.
This makes that wolf song like by Das Frog seem like it's written by Dylan.
Poor Das Frog.
So uncomfortable. Canadian weirdos. All right. A rooster writes in, it's a metaphor. No kidding, it's an idiotic metaphor.
Thank you, Rooster.
All right, let's hear some more.
All right.
And you know he's watching Wizard of Oz with the apples getting thrown.
How'd you like it if someone pulled apples off of you?
What? Fest is getting heavy.
Oh, we're getting serious again about these damn trees.
Getty's got all the weight of the world on those tiny little shoulders.
He's trying to make forest noises.
This is so Spinal Tap right here. Let's try to have it like we're beating on a log.
Now we're woodpeckers. Listen to us. It's almost magical.
This is why people don't live in Canada. They refuse to move there. Why do we need this extra time in the song? Because these musicians are so good? By the way, Yes called. They'd like their sound back as soon as possible. They like their pretentious sound back.
I think we're going to resolve the problem with the trees here. That's why people burn forests.
So heavy. Hey, Leo, are you still there?
Leo?
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm turning around on this. Phenomenal.
All right. So you take it back?
No, I don't take it back.
Oh, come on.
I'm trying to point it out
to you. All right, listen. This isn't their best.
Listen to this. It's
awful.
This
is their best. That's the sad thing.
Hey, it's good, but it's not their best.
Things all over the road.
Listen to the next track. It's a good 9 minutes long, but it'll have you convinced.
I don't have 9 minutes of my life to give the Rush. We're fighting.
like them. The Oaks are just too greedy.
So the
listen
trees,
to that message there.
They
that
turn
message.
On each other with hatchets,
axes, and saws. Oh, my.
Don't they have hands?
Well, no, they're trees.
Now, you know, we could have ended this thing with another 15 minutes earlier if they didn't feel the need. All right, here's Dave. Dave, you're on with Leo, the Rush fan.
Ron fan, shake it up.
Shake it up, buddy.
Shake it up. Leo, Rush, and you, very feminine. You got to go.
You gotta go.
Here's Brad.
Oh, I'm hurt.
Brad, you're on Run a Fez.
Guys, I gotta tell you, I was born and raised in Toronto, Canada. Up until 93, I left because Rush was on the radio every other song. They're horrible.
Hey, what is the deal with Canadian radio? A certain percentage of the bands always have to be Canadian, right?
Yeah, there's the CRTC in Canada, which is like the FCC here.
Yeah.
Governs Canadian radio that they have to play a certain percentage of Canadian artists.
Do you know what it
they
is?
All suck.
Isn't it like 70% and huge?
It is. It's pretty big. I mean, there's
I always
some
thought it was
Canadian,
like 40, but you know,
I'm not sure the exact.
That would
number.
Still be gigantic.
Sure.
I mean, yeah.
It's
I mean, I'm not
half.
Sure the exact. Yeah, I don't know the exact number, but I'll tell you, there's some good Canadian bands like the Tragically Hip, Our Lady Peace, things like that.
You know what's really funny though? Tragically Hip and Our Lady Peace, gigantic in Canada. And come down here and play clubs. But because
yeah.
they get the radio play, and it just goes to show you that, like, let's suppose that every state did the same thing. Where
right.
New York said, you got to play 30% New York music.
Right. Okay.
And Delaware did the same thing. You would have bands. You would have bands on the radio. And what, you know, what the hell would people do? You'd have to do it.
And that just proves how bad the Canadian music scene is. If their government's telling you have to play it, well then.
Yeah, but it's kind of cool, though, you know?
I don't know. That's one of the reasons. I'd rather listen to Ann Murray and Gordon Lightfoot.
Now you're talking.
Canadian rock.
An ordinary boy. An ordinary name. An ordinary just not good enough.
Doesn't it sound like a younger Geddy Lee?
A little bit.
When's he talking about trees?
Tomorrow night, the voting starts on RonFez.net. People writing on to me now, Fez, Roy, that they're scared because their band's not up yet. All the bands got to be up tomorrow, right?
Yep, we're going to be working all through the night to make sure that we get them all up.
Wow. Beautiful.
The marathon telethon.
RonFez.net.
Five of those bands are going to make it to the Rockin' Ribs. That's the Ron and Festival of Rockin' Ribs. Friday night, August 23rd at the Hard Rock Cafe. Also, if you're a big Ass Card member, make sure you check your email. It's something special for you.
I'm thinking why.
We'll be back tomorrow right after Opie and Anthony.
Opie and Anthony live tomorrow. Is that right? Or is it next day?
I think it's Thursday.
Why even bother? Just come back next week, guys.